morning, and welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
All righty. 866-901-ADAM, 866-901-ADAM is the phone number. What do we got on tap for today? Well, Ozzy, who I saw three times over the weekend, I get to see for a fourth time in about 33 hours, will be in here doing a movie review of Poseidon.
Did you see that?
I did see that.
I'm not surprised. And?
It was bad, and it was also...
richly hued review.
Well, hold on there, sweetie cakes. Teresa Strasser over there, for good, by the way. Thank Christ.
Thank you.
Dave Damashek, to her left. That would be my right.
Thank Christ.
It's weird because you try to... First off, everyone gave Mission Impossible a lot of crap last week. I don't have anything against Tom Cruise. I secretly suspect people are jealous of Tom Cruise and they lay it on because they can't stand a guy who's this goddamn happy about waking up every morning. It's sickening. And I agree, but that doesn't mean we should take it out on him. We should take a good look in the mirror. I can't stand the fact that he's so elated about everything he does. He has boundless energy. He seems so satisfied, albeit he seems a little nutty. But he seems like the happiest, richest nut I know. And I think we're all quietly envious, but we dig into him because we can't stand him because he reminds us of all the things that we're not. Like, I feel like he's living every day to its fullest, and I'm just waiting to die.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's a marginal difference. And I've taken a look within. I'm not going to get angry at Tom Cruise for pointing out how miserable I am. I'm just going to go home and watch TiVo and masturbate and think about how miserable I am. So I've taken my energy and channeled it in a positive direction.
Yeah, but it's sort of like I appreciate French, the language. I appreciate French, but I don't understand what language he's talking, Tom Cruise.
Yeah.
Trade places with his wealth and everything, but I wouldn't want to be jumping out of it for fun in real life. You know, he hot rods around and jumps out of planes. I'd much rather be watching TV.
Me too, but I think there's a part of us that isn't comfortable with that.
Yeah.
That's my point.
It's an interesting point you make.
And we go after him a little bit. Anyway, Mission Impossible opens last weekend at like $48 million. And everyone's like, oh, man, woohoo, not so good. Well, somebody's in trouble. Very disappointing. And then Poseidon opens at $20 million, not even half of what that opened. $20 million. So either people aren't interested in these movies or they're not really going out to the theaters just yet. Poseidon was a bad movie, but the thing I don't understand about how movies work is, did the first wave of people on Friday see it and report back to everyone they knew who was planning on going on seeing it either Saturday or Sunday? Don't bother. Don't waste his. It is amazing. I get the feeling if Poseidon was really good, it would have opened to $35 million, but it only opened to $20 million. But how does the word of mouth work, and does it work that fast?
I wonder, because it just struck me as, I rejected it out of hand. I didn't need to see any reviews. It just looked like a rehash of Titanic / the original Poseidon Adventure. So I just thought, what's the point? What do I need to run out to see this?
It's the original redone, but other movies are redone, and people go out and watch those.
I guess.
If you like the first one, you might like the second. Anything somebody dumps $165 million into, I will look at it. If you could find me $165 million BM, I would go look at it.
Well, I saw MI3.
Yes.
And I liked it.
Yes.
I think people have been soft-selling it a little bit.
A little bit. It was
a
good movie.
There's a lot of cool stuff in it. I'll tell you the best thing I can say about that picture. MI2, the thing that was most made fun of about that one when it came out about like 18 years ago or however long ago it was the thing with the masks. They kept peeling the face off.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so mocked, and it was such a ridiculous thing. And they turned it into, in MI3... arguably the coolest scene in the picture.
Yes.
The whole building of the face, because Tom Cruise does it to look like Philip Seymour Hoffman, and the whole construction of it and the voice simulation, all that stuff. It was maybe the best scene in the whole picture.
Yeah.
Kudos.
Yeah, no,
I say.
The movie was quite good.
Mm-hmm.
And Cruise was quite good in it, and the script was good, and nonstop action. It was quite a bit better than its competition, which is Poseidon.
Yes.
How say you? Have you seen any of these movies, Teresa?
This weekend I saw Thank You for Smoking.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you've seen that.
Yes. Fancy lady.
Seen that?
La-di-da. Yeah, mm-hmm. it was good, although mm-hmm. I can see why box office is down, because I went to the Arclight and then it was $28 to see the movie, and I was just like,
what?
This movie, well, for, you know, two of us, mm-hmm. I thought this better be really, really good.
Yeah.
It's $28.
I spent $20 a piece over at the Egyptian to sit in the VIP lounge.
Ooh.
What's that like?
They said I can't talk about it.
What?
It's for a different class of person. You understand? What they don't want is the little people down below riding, getting angry and storming my castle.
Mm. Right.
You understand? Let them eat cake. I say, well, I have a bottomless bucket of popcorn and Pepsi. Yeah, the VIP, and I like this, by the way. I wish Southwest Airlines had something like this. There's this thing where, like, look, the normal ticket is $10 or $12, but if you want to pay $20, you get to sit in these really, like, soft Italian leather seats that are almost like first-class airline seats, two at a time, and then a space, a good 3 feet between the next pairing of seats. So nobody at your right or your left, other than whoever you brought with you, you two get to kind of sit on your own. The things sort of recline, and you have a little concierge guy. He'll come up and bring you popcorn and Coke. You have to pay for it, but you just sit there and throw him the money. You know, sometimes you go to the Arclight, there's a line of Bohemians 26 deep where you have to just stand there and get in line. You know, oftentimes doing that thing where, honey, you stay behind and get the popcorn. I'll go ahead and get the seats and I'll fill you in on whatever you missed. This, you go, you sit, and I'm just, I'm all about it. I mean, this is my version of Tom Cruise jumping out of airplanes and doing wheelies and sandrails and things. I just pay an extra $8 and sit in the VIP, whatever.
But in your own way, adventurous.
Crazy.
Well,
yes. Climbing the seat.
A certain breed of cat, they call it. Yes.
Speaking of your honey, can I ask mm-hmm. how your wife is doing? How are the babies?
She's super crazy pregnant. She,
like, any day now, right?
That's what they say. She snores like a Samoan lineman. I had to ask her to roll over in bed and face the other direction last night. She was angry, then had acid reflux, and got up and slept on the sofa. More room for me. I had a nice argument over why I didn't get her flowers yesterday, because
uh-oh.
She's not technically a mother.
Oh! What'd you get her? Like a nose strip for her snoring?
I got her breathe right. And now I built some cabinets that are going into the nursery, which I decided to put a bow on. I mean, not literally, but figuratively, and call it the Mother's Day gift for her. But although Ozzy always makes me look bad by showing up and giving her flowers every year. Do you know that as Waldo goes to my mom's house, Lynette, my house, Lynette's mom, and who am I missing? Oh, my grandmother, and gives them flowers every Mother's Day.
My God.
That's adorable.
He drives all over town dropping off flowers. He's like the Mexican FTD man.
Yeah, Santa Claus.
What a jerk.
Yeah. I know, it makes me look like a retard when Ozzy shows up with flowers and I got nothing. And he then comes back later yesterday in the day and brings me smoked salmon and asparagus to eat.
Wow.
I saw Ozzy on, I don't know if I saw him Saturday, some Friday, and then two times yesterday, and maybe just a glimpse on Saturday.
I got to get in better with Ozzy.
No, he'll take care of you.
That's
bring
fantastic.
The kids flowers, everything. All right, where were we? That's right. Yes, we're going to talk names in 1 second. Billy, our webmaster, is going to work on his prom day, and I think
our green room's crawling with teenage girls.
Yeah,
candidates for Billy.
Most cute. Prom's coming up end of this week, Saturday.
Saturday night for Billy.
All right, so we'll see what we can do for him. Teresa, you had a list of the most popular names?
Yes. You know, every year, the Social Security Administration publishes a list of the most popular names.
Mm-hmm.
2005, do you want to hear the girls' names?
Sure.
From number 1 to number 10, Emily, the most popular name. Mm-hmm. Then Emma, Madison, Abigail, Olivia.
Oh, stop it. That's ridiculous.
What?
Those are the most, that's the most given name in America. That's not true. Yeah. Emily is more popular than, you know, Jennifer or something like that.
Sadly, these are Anglo names, but...
Yes.
Marisol's probably number one reality.
In L.A.
Sadly, yes.
Olivia. Isabel, yes. Hannah, Samantha, Ava, and Ashley.
Mm-hmm.
So those names might be kind of out for you.
Hmm. Well, let's see. Emma's a nice name. Emily's a nice name. But yes, the Abigail, all these Madison, all these old school names are all having a renaissance. Olivia, Isabella, Hannah, they're all, with the exception of possibly Samantha and Ashley, they're all old school. Let's go over to the dudes' names.
The dudes, number one, I was kind of surprised, Jacob.
Is Jacob having a renaissance because people want, they like Jake?
Jake.
Yeah,
they
want to
call everyone Jake?
Yeah. I like that.
That is the most given name in America.
Yeah, unbelievable.
I don't buy it.
By the way, it has been for 7 years in a row. Number
Jacob.
One.
Yeah. Here's what I worry about. Jacob, there were only a handful of guys named Jake, and Jake was a Jake. Jake was the tough guy.
It's a cool name.
Jake was the guy you'd want on your side if trouble broke out. Now that everyone's, you know, dentists and doctors and lawyers are naming their kids Jacob, which will turn into Jake. Now we're going to have a lot of wussy Jakes floating around out there. And what it does is it dilutes the pool,
the Jake pool.
Of real Jakes. It oversaturates.
Yeah.
And now there's a lot of guys who are more have bigger noses than they have arms walking around, and they're named Jake, and everyone's kicking their ass. And before you knew it, you're living in a world where a guy named Harold is kicking the crap out of a guy named Jake, and I don't want to live in that world.
It's confusing.
It's confusing. Confusing. We're going to have like Jakes and Spikes, and they're going to be having their homosexual relationships while the Heralds and the Poindexters are beating the crap out of them and pulling straight D's on their report cards. And I don't like that. I believe if your kid, look, if you're a professional fighter or mixed martial arts fighter and you marry a heavy set woman, name your kid Jake. But if you're a couple of attorneys, no.
Don't sully the good name.
You're ruining the name Jake.
Jake the Snake made out of
right.
Jake. Jake,
right.
I mean, Jake the Snake, remember his feats in
right.
the ring.
That's
in the,
right.
In the squared circle. He would not just defeat you with the STD move.
Right.
Then he would go into his bag and take the snake out.
Yeah.
And he'd embarrass you. He'd shame you by he put the snake on
Jake
you.
Jake the Snake.
What is an STD move?
DTD. I said STD. DDT.
The DDT move, yes.
I'm sorry.
How did you spend your 80s?
Well,
shame on
at
you.
A few clinics. The other popular names, Matthew, Ethan, Andrew, Daniel, Anthony, Christopher.
Joshua's three.
Yeah, Josh. Josh is a cute name. I like that name.
No.
Matthew, Ethan. Ethan's a little
Ethan's
nerdy,
sexy.
But not bad. Kind of
like
cute,
him.
Yeah. Andrew, Daniel, Anthony's number eight. What are the last two?
Christopher and Joseph.
Mm-hmm.
Chris is a good name.
Joe isn't bad.
Joe, not bad. But again, wondering if Joe's going to get effed out a little bit.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And there's going to be a lot of pretentious, waspy kids walking around named Joe.
An important note is when you're naming a child, I feel, like Joshua, for instance.
Right.
Don't go with, don't call him Joshua.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know Mr. Joshua, Gary Busey, was cool in Lethal Weapon as Joshua, but since then, like that guy on West Wing, he goes by Joshua.
Mm-hmm.
That's queer.
Yeah.
Don't do that to your child.
I agree. And whatever it is, it is. If you're Chris for most of your life and you try to pull off the Christopher somewhere in your mid-20s,
too late.
Sorry.
I have great admiration for Jimmy Kimmel, a chief among anything, above everything else. That instead of becoming Jim, which would be the instinct as a teen or as an adult, I'm not Jimmy. I'm not a child anymore. I'm now a man. I'm now Jim Kimmel.
Yeah.
He'd be an entirely different man if he were Jim Kimmel.
Nice, Jimmy Kimmel. As a matter of fact, he's so stuck in his adolescence, he told me yesterday he wanted to add a third M to Jimmy. Yes, he wanted to go down that much lower.
Replace the Y with two E's.
I was going to get to that, but she cut me off.
I'm sorry.
He said that Jimmy didn't sound adolescent enough, and that for his 37th birthday, he was going to add a third M and replace the Y. Well, not replace, slide the Y over.
Right.
So he was going to now spell his name J-I-M-M-M-E-E-Y. Jimmy.
No, there was talk early on that you wanted to have an Italian name for your kids. Have you given up on that? Are you still looking for?
No, still working on it.
Popular Italian names. I've just looked them up. Teresa, number 7 in Italy.
Mm-hmm.
It's an okay name.
Mm-hmm.
Giuseppe for a boy. Giovanni, Antonio, Mario, Luigi, Vincenzo.
Vincenzo, kind of interesting. A little much. A little preachy.
Yeah, Carlo.
A little bit of mouthful. Not bad, but I was going to call him Carlos.
That's true. Franco?
Not bad.
Bruno?
Not bad. Bruno. Yeah, not bad.
That's pretty good. Giorgio?
Yeah, you know, the thing about them is they're all those Italian names should be good, solid sevens, you know?
Yeah.
Nothing lower, but not much above it either. Look, I've been trying to sell this one to my wife. Let's live with the kid. Let's kick the tires. Let's see what they look like. I swear to Christ, I don't know if they're a Harold or a former Jake.
Right.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Good for you.
That's what you do with a pet. You get the pet, and then you name it based on its personality.
Right. If it's energetic, it's scrappy. You know, if it sleeps a lot, nappy. Then there's always the fur ball. And, you know, sometimes you call them skunk. They got a stripe on them or something like that.
Spot.
You know, spot. That's what you do with pets. Why? You owe the same to your children.
I love it. That's a good idea.
And not only to your children, what about society? Like I've said many times, if you name your kid a name that doesn't work for the kid, society will never remember it. We all know those handful of a-holes work around the office somewhere that don't look anything like their name, and you can never remember it. You know, if there's a heavy-set woman of color and her name is Jack A., no problem.
Mm-hmm.
Done and done. Remember it the first time you see him. Or if there's that guy who's kind of cool and a little slender, doesn't talk much, but he's everyone's buddy, and his name is Jim, fine, done. But if there's some guy who has a mullet and a bad tat, and his name is Harold, you'll never remember it.
Mm-hmm.
You just won't. He doesn't look like his name. If you don't, we don't have enough time to invest psychologically in everybody. If you don't look like your name, it doesn't catch. If it doesn't catch the first few times around, it doesn't work because you don't look like your name. I think we need to do that.
You're going to wait. So you're not going to name the baby. But you'll do it by like the time the kid's like 12 or 13, right?
Well, we'll see if something's emerged. Let him hit puberty, I say. Mark?
Yes, good morning, Adam.
Good morning, Mark. You have a limerick?
Mark the poet?
I do. It is, and I am.
Do you have a limerick for Teresa?
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I wrote this for Teresa while she was out.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to sound like Charlie Sheen, but this is the hardest I've ever been. The Adam Carolla show had to choose, and they went with someone sexy smart to do the news. Now Teresa Strasser jumping on a trampoline.
Mm.
Wow. Mm,
yeah.
In the limerick format.
No, that's good. That's solid.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you're flattering.
Welcome, sister. Mm-hmm. Keep it going.
Thank you.
The best part about that it was very short, and we didn't have to hear him too
long.
Yes. Roska coming down on Mark the Poet.
I think he's the greatest poet of our generation based on that.
She's not the greatest poet of this show.
Yeah.
Brandon Damashek has put him to shame a couple of times.
Well, hopefully he's listening and he'll have a rebuttal before the day's over. We will take ourselves a little break. We'll bring our 17-year-old webmaster, Billy. Looks like he got himself a new hairdo.
Suddenly a stud.
Yeah.
Women. He's got a gaggle of babes waiting for him.
Brimming with confidence until Damashek brings him in here and says the star he most resembles is one of the bikers from Any Which Way But Loose.
Right. And the head biker of the Black Widows.
Yes.
What do you want me to tell you?
All right. We'll take ourselves a quick break. We'll bring in Billy, and we'll interview some prospective prom dates after this.
Sadly, this will be the best part of your day. The Adam Carolla Show.
Fast food is one thing that has not gone up in price at all. Everything was a buck when I was a kid, and gas was 75 cents, and now it remains a buck, and gas is $4.
Hey, everyone's entitled to Adam's opinion. The Adam Carolla Show. And now, Oswaldo reads the 100 greatest movie quotes of all time. Number 25, from Jerry Maguire.
Show me the money.
Now, back to the Adam Carolla Show.
Mm-hmm. Oswaldo, going to be in here with a stirring review of Poseidon in a couple of few, but first, unfinished business. We have Billy. He's our webmaster.
Yes, sir.
Sweet as sugar. Yeah. 17 and ready to party, ladies.
Ready.
And he's single, ladies.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wait.
They don't do that when a guy's gay. He's single, fellas. He's single, ladies. 17. He goes to Rio Hondo High School.
High School.
He goes to Rancho de Jefe High School out in, where is it?
In Paramount.
Buena Vista.
Yeah.
It's a continuation school.
Alternative. They hate that word, continuation.
It's alternative.
Yeah.
To
yes.
What?
To learning. Basically what it is. Like, look, we got too much pride and we want to keep too much of the taxpayers' money to send you losers home to just watch cable TV. So we're going to warehouse you here for another 18 months and then we'll send you home to watch cable TV. That's basically how it goes.
Carolla for president.
Thank you. There's nothing going on over there. You're basically talking to your teacher like this. Hey, Ken, can I bum a smoke off you? Thanks. You know where to score any good reefer? Or you dry too. All right. What time is it? 11:30? Jeez, I've been here since 9:45. I'm going to split. I'll be smoking weed in the van if you need me. Yeah, the reading this weekend's optional, right? Yeah. I'm going to let you know right now I'm not going to do it.
Yeah.
Fantastic. See you, Ken. Hey, buddy. And by the way, you got my hacky sack. I expect to see it on Monday. Take care, buddy. All right. And you shouldn't wear socks with those sandals. Looks better when you just go barefoot. So Nicole is here.
Yes.
Nicole was one of the original folks who responded to our cry because Billy needs a prom date. The prom is coming up Saturday. Yes?
5 short days away.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And right he's not going to be the loser that stays home on prom night.
I'm not.
You're single?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And I would guess, ladies, he's in between bitches, as he says.
Yeah.
Yeah. Basically, there's a very small window. It's like when a house goes up on the real estate market and it only goes up every 40, 50 years. It's a very small window. You got to get in. You got to try to outbid the competitors because it's only a few moments a guy like Billy's going to be single. He's a webmaster. He's a lone wolf. He plays by his own rules.
Yeah.
Freshly shorn locks.
Yes.
Not unlike Brad Pitt.
Looking good.
Crew cut.
Getting in shape, looking tough. So let's start at the front of the line. We have three prospective guests. Melinda, you're number one, yes?
Yeah.
You're the cousin of our intern, Mike.
Yeah.
You've been homeschooled. You're homeschooled for the sixth grade.
Yeah, that's true.
Seems like trouble. And you're our 17-year-old sophomore in high school.
Yeah, that's right.
Let me tell you something. I've had a few friends who didn't get pushed on, you know. And once in a while, someone would miss a grade. And it's always humiliating when people would say, you're 18 and you're in the 11th grade or you're in the 10th grade. And a lot of people make a lot of excuses. Let me tell you the best one I've ever heard. And if anyone's listening, feel free to use it. You went to Europe. Your family moved back to Europe for a year and a half between the third and fourth grade.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, you go from imbecile to international superstar.
Yeah.
Man about town. So just say that. Look, anyone who hears me, if you're smart enough to use this advice, if you got held back a grade or two for whatever reasons, disciplinary reasons, scholastic reasons, uh-uh. You went to Europe for a year. No one will ever check up on it, and it makes your family seem sort of international. It's nice. Here you are in the 11th grade. People want to know why you're 19 years old. You tell them when you're in the third grade. You went back to Denmark for 3 years. That's all. You seem smart. No one ever looks into it, and you're off the hook. You move forward.
Clever.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And you say, you know, my dad worked for Boeing or something like that.
Boom. Back in Europe,
but
no one ever questions you.
The real truth is, Melinda, as we learned last week, at the end of last week, there were some very mysterious family issues that held you back.
Yes. Yes. One's mind reels at the possibilities. But you're okay now?
Yeah, I'm fine.
You're fine? And you're going to school in Monrovia?
Yeah.
So you now have you've not been asked to your prom?
No.
It's your school. But no. Again, you're just a sophomore.
Right.
Shannon is next. Shannon is 19 years of age.
Spoke to Shannon on Friday morning past as well. You'll remember her. She had a little frog in her throat. That's not unlike Chewbacca.
Be nice, Brian.
Go ahead. You decorate cakes for a living, yes?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And you're a freshman at Saddleback Junior College.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, perhaps you and Billy, who goes to the alternative school, could attend the prom, you going to junior college, and you could discuss your love for scholastic debauchery.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes, you both are horrible students, or you wouldn't be in the predicament you're in.
Exactly.
Now, you were a bad student in junior in high school?
Goofed off a lot.
You goofed off a lot. And have things changed in college?
Absolutely not.
Right, that's my point.
Now, did you still graduate?
Yeah, I graduated.
what class were you?
05.
Okay, cool.
And what's going on with the voice? Is that
bronchitis right now?
Yeah, bronchitis. And is it anything that Billy could catch?
I don't think so.
Why not?
It's chronic bronchitis.
It's chronic.
Yeah, it's like I have it all the time. It comes when I'm stressed out or nervous.
Okay. All right. I'm sorry. Now I feel bad.
Waging war up on the Death Star ain't easy. It takes a little something out of you.
All right, and now we move ahead to Nicole, who we started with. Nicole, let's see, just got a job with Baskin-Robbins.
That's right.
Sweet. That's what you call a perk, literally. Billy.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
You live with your sister.
Yes, I do.
Who is your guardian?
Uh-huh.
Uh-oh. What's up? What happened?
I was with my mom, but she's not really in any position to be a mom right now, so my sister took me in.
Hmm. And dad?
Dad is not living.
Oh, what happened?
I haven't seen him since I was a really little kid, so I really have no idea. He died in 98, so.
Ooh. And you okay, or?
Yeah, I'm fine. I'm great.
All right. Let me translate there, Billy.
Okay.
Living with sister, crazy family. This is a good time for a couple of nights, and then eventually turns into trouble. You just have to be prepared. That's all I'm saying.
May I say quickly, just to set the table here very quickly, Melinda, who we heard from first, a dark-haired woman, wavy, long hair, attractive, comely. You know, she's got very feminine sort of features, you know, bluish eyes.
Is comely the same as comely?
I was wondering the same.
No, she needs to comb.
She needs to comb her long hair, yes.
Comely,
right. And then there's...
Didn't dress to seduce today, however.
Oh, what sweatshirt. Are you talking about?
She has on a sweatshirt that's three sizes too big. Listen, far be it from me to review the looks of minors. I'm just saying, she didn't dress to seduce today like most of her peers.
Actual minors dress better for work, is what you're saying.
No, but it's kind of a hard to get theme.
I like that.
No, but that's a very interesting point, which is she's not dressed to seduce.
Mm-hmm.
What would she wear to the prom?
It's a good point. Nicer sweat jacket?
No, I wouldn't wear a jacket.
Is that one reversible?
No.
What would you wear to the prom? Do you have a dress? And what about you, ladies? Do you have a dress? Yes?
Yeah, I do.
What? You have one that you've kept at home? Melinda, you answer first. You have a dress?
I have my homecoming dress at my house.
Oh, really? You're a princess?
No.
In the court? You just wore it to the dance?
Yeah, I went for fun with my friends.
Uh-huh. And then Shannon, what do you have?
Yeah, I have a gold dress.
You have a gold dress? maybe just decorate yourself with one of those caked things, you know? Put a little, huh? No?
No, it's frosting. Pretty, though.
All right. Nicole, what do you got?
Yes, I have dresses from previous dances, like winter formal, so.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well, you're looking good, so you're ready to go.
Okay. Yeah, all right. Now, Shannon is the tallest of the three women.
Mm-hmm.
Dirty blonde hair, shall we call it?
Blondish, reddish, brownish.
Yes.
No, it's really all three. I wasn't lying.
19 years of age, a full-figured woman, bosomy. Blue-eyed as well.
It depends. Depends what you like. All the women are attractive, but you have different styles, different sizes, and it depends what young Billy's into.
And Nicole is the most diminutive of the trio.
Mm-hmm.
Blonde, long hair.
Yes,
you know, small as we say,
but comely or in her own way.
Is this the game we're gonna play?
No,
correcting you
pronunciation.
No,
Billy has said before that Nicole
is a fox.
Is hot. Mm-hmm. He's referred to her as hot when he saw her on Friday.
Mm-hmm. Has your opinion changed at all, Billy?
No.
All right. Should we figure this out now, or should we tease it a little bit and figure it out a little later in the show? I think we'll do that. All right.
Let them sweat, these three ladies, as they pine for Billy and his crew cut.
And Billy, you stare at the ladies. Now, ladies, what do you think of Billy, by the way? Melinda?
He's really nice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
If you went to the prom, is any sparks between the two of you? Brian says
I
no.
I even got my hair cut over the weekend to prepare for this.
Yeah. What about if you went to the prom with him? Would there be the possibility of romance?
I don't know. I'd probably have to get to know him a little bit better.
Mm-hmm.
That's fair.
Shannon, yeah. How say you?
He looks pretty manly. Like I could feel secure.
So does that mean the possibility of romance?
We'll see.
We'll see. All right. Nicole?
Actually, I've talked to him a couple times, and we're hitting it off pretty well. He's really cool.
Ooh.
Yeah. Can I suggest something here?
Smart.
I think this is what we need to have happen, is Billy needs to go off with the three ladies. You ever see that show, Elimidate?
Mm-hmm.
When they go and he spends time, and then he kicks one off,
right,
and then another one off.
Right.
Maybe over the course of the show, Billy could eliminate one of these three,
mm-hmm,
send them packing. So be it, cutthroat style. Send one of them up, and then he has to eliminate. He should spend time with them. How's he to decide?
I agree. Yeah. All right, and time alone. I think with the three together sitting at the table over there, it's uncomfortable.
Oh, I think both. Yeah. Maybe there could be some one-on-one time and some group time.
All right. Any way we want to do it, let's do it. And when we come back a little bit later in the show, Billy will have decided on just two ladies.
Right.
And then we'll figure it out from there.
Let's do it.
All right, ladies. Nice job.
All right.
We need to take ourselves a break, except for somebody's crazy's on the phone. Crazy guy?
Yeah.
What's going on?
Can I get an orientation?
Sure.
Okay, where are you all the time on all the places, all the countries?
We're in some of the places, some of the time. I don't think all the time in all the places would be fair to the people who lived in all those places.
Man, I'm crazier than a rabbit's ass.
I don't know. It'd be better if since your enthusiasm level, your vocabulary is wide, but your enthusiasm is Casey Kasem'd.
Mm-hmm.
As to what we want Howard back.
What's, you want Howard back?
Well, yeah, he encourages me to be crazy.
Wait a second. What about my enthusiasm? I'm the Casey Kasem enthusiasm I'm curious about. Is that good or is that bad?
It's muffled in the middle. You're monotone. You have no optimism to life.
Now, sir.
Yeah.
Please be honest.
Yeah.
You seem like a professional.
Yes, it's caused by overeating and addiction of what's his farm.
Are you a heavy set man? Do you need a prom date? Because there are going to be two ladies here.
Feather light and able to handle women.
You've never been able to handle women?
No.
Just what I pictured.
I save it all to be crazy.
Mm-hmm. Ladies, Billy's seeming more attractive by the minute, is he not?
Yes.
You see? How old are you, crazy guy?
Well, let's see here. Do you think I'm old enough to get SSI for craziness?
I can't even get that at any age.
Now, see, if he's acting crazy intentionally, he's acting too crazy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, therefore, I don't think he's acting.
Yes, if this pre is scripted, checker-peckered lane of Howard's.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. Where are you calling from?
Fudd City.
Fudd City.
Hmm.
Yes, I always like to advertise. Careful. Jewish, yes.
You're Jewish.
Well, Westinghouse.
Please do not be Jewish.
It's coal factor. You have to have a outside... outside commercial in order to be Jewish or Westinghouse.
All right, hang on a second, crazy guy.
I'm really crazy.
I'm in no S, Sherlock.
Yeah. I'm a simplified.
Russ, I would like to hear from you more often.
Oh.
Makes me feel saner.
Yes, I'm your glide, your citizen squint mark.
Okay, hang on a second.
He makes a lot of good points.
Yeah. All valid. Every time... I hear from somebody like a crazy guy here. You know, people always talk about how many guns are in our society and how nutty the majority of society is. I'm always surprised. You know, you hear about the Columbines or you hear about someone walks into McDonald's and shoots the place up. But I'm surprised it doesn't happen 10 times a day in every major city in the country every single day, including Sunday. Aren't you?
Yeah.
I mean, when you walk up and down the street and you see people... pushing a lamp and talking to it, you know, wearing one slipper and the other foot's bare, and you get a random sampling of people that call into this show and that you just see on the news and that kind of stuff, and then you find out there's, you know, 1.8 handguns for every citizen in the United States, including toddlers and infants, and then you realize, once a year, somebody walks into some post office and shoots the place up, and that's a disgruntled employee. Not too bad. You know, no one ever really focuses on that. But you'd think this would happen every single day in every place of work, in every big business, or at every shopping mall around the country. Wouldn't you?
I hear you. Yeah. It's weird, though, this guy. I can't tell. You're right that he's so crazy, and he keeps announcing how crazy he is. If he's doing a bit, it's hard to, you know, he's gone too far with it.
Crazy guy?
Yeah, I mean, sure, though, on getting sycophanted to a citizen Columbine.
Uh-huh. And so do you work?
So Orson is so out of it.
Mm-hmm. This is damn exciting stuff.
All right, we're going to take ourselves a break. Do you have a first name?
You think like terminalized.
Oh.
Right.
Catchy. Yeah. I think that was on the 10 most popular names list.
Right. All right. Yeah, it was number 11.
Out with citizens.
All right. Hang on a second, crazy guy. We'll take ourselves a break. Billy.
Yeah.
Go kick some tires.
I will.
Look at the 2007s are in early.
Yeah.
Go look at them new models.
Yeah.
They have the new date smell. Give them a sniff. See who you like. And coming up after Ozzy's movie review, we'll bring back a couple of the candidates and we'll make a decision for Saturday night. Yes, ladies?
Yeah.
We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
Can't get enough? Check out Adam on the web at adamcarolla.com.
I never got past high school math, so I'm not sure what pi is exactly, but any equation that involves dessert, I'm in for.
Adam will never run out of opinions. The Adam Carolla Show.
It's time now for free advice from heavyweight champion James Lights Out Tony.
Dear James Tony, what should I have said to my new 24-year-old stepdaughter who started bawling when her father and I told her that we eloped? The first thing out of her mouth was to ask her father, "Did you make her sign a prenup?" I have never in my life felt so humiliated and offended by someone else's rude behavior. Part of me never wants to see her again. Any suggestions? Crushed in California.
Dear Crushed, I don't blame you. Blame you for feeling her behavior was rude, tacky, inappropriate, and cruel. But you are a family now. And face it, you will be seeing her again. So my recommendation is to recognize that she was shocked and forgive her conduct and loss of control. But don't forget it.
Free advice from heavyweight champion James Lights Out Tony.
Sound, as usual. Speaking of sound, someone you're not going to be able to understand the sounds of, Ozzy is coming in. He's got his Poseidon review coming up next break. Drunken Tree mascot back. Hope she sobered up. American Idol cast off. Chris Daugherty, or Daughtry, I should say. And do we need a Daugherty and a Daughtry?
We've got Shannon Daugherty.
One of them is going to have to go to Daughtry or both Daugherty.
Seems fair.
It doesn't seem like I can't remember both of them. Shannon Daugherty, Chris Daughtry. All right. And actor Frank Vincent from The Sopranos.
You watched that last night?
Yeah, I saw Gay Vito kissing, and I had to avert my gaze, and my wife told me to grow up. I actually held my hand up in front of my... Oh, Jesus Christ. Just got done watching 7 hours of bukkake porn, by the way, and then had to hold the hand up when the two actors pretended to kiss. Very sad. Very sad. All right, couple things I want to talk about apropos of nothing. I had to have the phone company come out and hook up a few extra phones at a place of business that I'm involved with over the weekend. Or I shouldn't say over the weekend. I think it was last week, Thursday or something like that. And they did that thing that I forgot about because it's been a while, the window. Needed to have someone there between 8 a.m. and 4 p.m. And it's an empty warehouse. So it became a struggle. Who's going to go over there? I can't go over there. I have to work. Maybe I could make it there by 1 o'clock, but we need someone there by 8. And it's funny. You think, not 8:05, 8. Because your worst case, your worst thing in the world is to get there 5 minutes after the guy left, although they never get there at 8. When they do the window between 8 and 4, they usually show up about 3:45 or, and this is what I love, once in a while they don't show up at all. And then when you call the phone company and go, hey, the guy flaked out, he never made it, they go, sorry, we'll have a guy there tomorrow between 8 and 4. And you go, wait, I killed an entire day waiting today and nobody showed up. Yeah, yeah, that's it. That's their policy. And they know you can just shove off. Go. I'll tell you what then, Smarty Pants, Ma Bell, why don't you set a few of those telephone poles, string a couple million feet of wire, and start your own phone company. Or we'll have a guy out there between 8 and 4
They got you
tomorrow.
Over the barrel. And
over the barrel. And the thing that's funny, too, is it's not between the window between 8 and 4. And by the way, that's not a window. That's a sliding glass door. Window's a little bit smaller. A window would suggest between...
A three-car garage door. Right?
That's what it is. A window's between 8 and 10. 2 hours is a window. 6 hours is a gaping meteorite-sized hole in the side of the house with the curtains blowing. That is not a window. But whenever they do that thing where it's like, well, it's between 8 and 4, you'd think, well, all right, what'd you do? Make the appointment the afternoon of the day before? Oh, no. The appointment was made 10 days in advance. That's what you get. That's the thing that's amazing about the whole phone company or the cable or whoever else has the ridiculous windows. You make the thing on May 9th, the guy's coming out May 17th and he needs that window. It's one thing if like, look, if you want a guy to come out tomorrow, I can't promise you anything, but we'll try to get a guy there between this hour and that hour. Oh no, this is 2 weeks in advance, the same window. And you think to yourself, why do they have the window? Well, because they're the only game in town and that's where the window comes from. The second there's 100 phone companies is the second there's no window. Open the phone book, get to any place that's fat, like termite control, pest control, carpet cleaning, anything in the phone book where there's 10 pages and 150 companies, no window. Mm-hmm. As long as there's another company just underneath and just above the one you're calling, there's zero windows. And ultimately, everyone, this is why communism will not work and never did and can't. Because it's like an entire society where the DMV, the phone company, and one cable company call all the shots, and therefore you have an entire company, have an entire country of windows. That's the way it works. I don't understand why people don't understand that. I was watching 60 Minutes last night. There's some new guy, some black school principal in Harlem. He's getting everyone to come out. He's rejuvenating and revamping everything. And he pays kids for their attendance.
I saw this. $10 if they, you know, make it to class. And it's a brilliant incentive. Why not? Because the point he made was it's going to cost, you know, however many thousands to keep someone in prison.
Right. It's going to cost $45,000 a year to house these people when they go to prison. This way, Fresca comes over and points.
At what?
Insultingly points at the calls when I'm in the middle of a jag.
I'm chubby or I'm a lesbian.
I understand that there are people on the phone.
When you're done.
All right. The point is it costs...
I'm not saying that.
I'm never done, Brusca. The point is yes, if it's going to cost $45,000 a year to incarcerate somebody, how about give them $20 a month to get their make their attendance perfect? And believe me, people freak out over it. You shouldn't be paying kids. How does life work?
Incentives, financial right. incentives, and competition in the marketplace.
That's the only way it works. The reason you come to work every day is because you get paid, not because of your you have pride or your perfect attendance record or any of that. You get a paycheck, and if you miss too many days, you don't get a paycheck. Why not just start that in school? Mm-hmm. That's all. What, do you think kids inherently should have a love of school or should have a love of learning? Nick?
Yeah.
You have a window question?
No, well, you were saying you were waiting for phone company, right, all right. day long. Well, I install air conditioners, and when you have to wait for an inspector all day long, kind of, and they don't show up,
yes.
you've been there 8 hours.
Building inspectors are the same way. Building inspectors do that. Again, when there's one of anything, just like in Russia, when there's one supermarket, eventually it opens at noon and it closes at 2 p.m. because there's one. Whenever there's one, there's nothing. Mm-hmm. And that's all. That's people need incentive, and I don't understand why people don't understand that. That's the only way people work. The same person, the same horrible student, is capable of never showing up or showing up every day, depending on what if you make it worth their while. That's all. Communism's one big phone company, one big cable company, and one big building inspector. And by the way, you know, you want to complain about the city, you want to complain about the DMV, you want to complain about the road workers, you want to complain about Department of Building and Safety, all these kinds of things. The reason they're slower than molasses over there and everything's antiquated and it's a disaster, because there's one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they don't have to work hard. You have to go there.
Yes, you need them. Competition breeds success. Mm-hmm. All right.
By the way, though, let me quickly ask you this. What sort of shady business are you running out of a warehouse? Are you moving arms or something?
I'm moving white slavery. I like the white slavery. I'm against slavery, but white slavery I still find intriguing.
Yes, I wouldn't.
Why? Because slavery involves picking things and harvesting crops and stuff. White slavery, that's sex. You don't take white slaves and send them out to the fields. You send them into the bedroom.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
White slave. Yeah, I wouldn't feel morally bankrupt having a white slave.
No, you're just going to have a little sex on her. That's all.
She's on her?
That's right.
Near her?
With her?
Whatever. You know what I'm saying. We're going to take ourselves a... tricks the phone and cable company. Wait a minute. Maybe this is a tip here. Jordan?
Hey, what's up, Carolla?
What do you got for us?
Hey, your show is awesome, man.
Thanks.
Hey, what I do is about maybe 2 or 3 times a week, I call phone companies or I call cable companies or I just call different kind of companies, like you said, the window people.
Mm-hmm.
I have them come out to my house, but I'm never there.
Nice. You'll show them.
He's the reason you have the window.
Right.
You like that window? Come on.
No, look, I agree, really. 6 hours. Do they ever really take a look at themselves, you know? And they always do the same thing. Well, you just never know. I mean, somebody... Yes, nobody in any job, in any endeavor ever knows. If you own a company where you install drywall, you hang doors, you clean carpets, you go to people's homes and give their pets astrological readings, no company ever knows. You know, you could be a personal trainer who meets with clients at their house you never know, but that's what you do when there's competition.
We can estimate how long something's going to take. If you go to a doctor's office, now I understand the inability to gauge how long it's going to take. Oh, they're in there for something simple. Oh, wait, I better take a look at this.
Right.
It looks like this is more serious, and now suddenly the schedule's backed up. If you're going to hook somebody's cable up, what surprises you that suddenly, oh, this is going to take me 3.5 more hours than I expected?
You may show up and just screw some coaxial into the back of a set, or you may have to build a ship in a bottle. You never know. You never know. You could have to perform an emergency angioplasty, or you may just screw in one piece of coax. I know. They know. They don't care. And with 2 weeks advance notice, 6 hours, and again, this is why communism cannot work. Impossible. As long as there's human beings living in the country that decides to go communist, it's impossible to work because of human nature, which is inherent in all human beings. Doesn't matter what part of the world you're from. Doesn't matter what skin color you're from. If you're the only game in town, there will be a 6 hour. Think about this. It's not 2 hours, not 4 hours. It's a 6 hour window. But I would say we would all have the exact same six-hour window. If there was no other radio show on in the mornings, eventually this morning show would start at 1 in the afternoon. I would be loaded by 1:15, and it would end between 1:45 and 2 o'clock, depending on how much of vitriol I wanted to spew about my mother. That's all. That's how the show would work. That's exactly how it works. All right, the more you know. We got the news coming up. What's coming up in the news, Teresa?
Well, conspiracy theories abound about Chris Daughtry's ouster from Idol. We're going to have him on.
Interesting.
Yes, I'll discuss that in the news. And also, Tom Hanks is going to tell us what makes him so able to convey deep thoughts as an actor.
I may have a song, too.
And there may be some stuff about Bush.
Orlando?
Yes, sir.
Quick building question.
Yeah. Okay. See, this is what happened. My wife bought a house down in Mexico about 6 months ago. Mm-hmm. She had the floor.
There's a huge difference between purchase and bought.
Yeah, bought. Yes. But anyway, she had a wood installed on the floor. Uh-huh. Now what happened is it's starting to come up. Uh-huh. You know, it's like there's air coming from...
It's bubbling.
Bubbling,
It's buckling. You have a moisture problem, my friend.
So how do we fix this?
The hardwood is coming up from the subfloor.
Yeah.
Is it on a slab?
Yeah. It's on a concrete.
Concrete slab.
Yeah.
You need a vapor barrier.
Oh.
Yeah, you're going to have to pull the whole thing up and put down some, like, you know, 10 mil visqueen or something, some plastic, and then put it down on top of the plastic.
So take the whole thing out.
Well, it's buckling, right?
Yeah, but not the whole floor, though. Just, like, portions, you know.
Well, tell your wife to put on a couple of pounds there and hold it down. Stand on the bubbling parts. Look, here's the deal. If you have a slab and you don't put a vapor barrier on top of it and you just put wood on top of it, it may wick up some moisture and buckle the floor.
You don't think of moisture coming through concrete.
Oh, yes. Passes quite easily through concrete. Quite a bit. You have to seal it. All right, we'll take a break. We'll do the news. We'll do the sports. We got the We got the drunken tree mascot coming in here. Also, Ozzy has his Poseidon review. All that still coming up.
The Adam Carolla Show. News, sports, and so much more.
Baseball great Pete Rose in studio.
He could have been the hit king without a bat.
Tony Perez.
Wow. Is that right?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, he wore three shower shoes.
Holy cow!
We'll be right back with much more on The Adam Carolla Show. Here she is, Carolla's news girl. She's Teresa Strasser. You might know her from While You Were Out. She has also won an Emmy as a writer. And may I say, she's easy on the eyes. You could get wood just from her picture. They tried other girls, but one stood out. She was the best, without a doubt. Brown hair, brown eyes, an intelligent babe. She fits in just right.
Just right.
She is Carolla's new girl.
Rich Banks for Ass Kiss Rodeo Mare.
Mm-hmm. I love that song.
Sure, why not? I'd love it too.
By the way, you remember when Burt Bacharach and Elvis Costello got together? Two of the greatest songsmiths of the generation combined their efforts.
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly what Rich Banks and I have done as we've crafted songs together. We're a wonderful duo.
Another Chichu Temu song coming up for us.
The Rodgers and Hammerstein.
Oh, I've got one song.
One?
Oh no.
Half?
More than that?
Oh,
no.
Jason.
Hey, Adam.
You have a way to beat the window problem when the phone or the cable company says they'll have a guy? And I literally, a few years ago, had a guy in the cable company have between 8 a.m. and 6 p.m. as the window for coming out to the house.
Yeah,
yes.
I know, Adam. You're the best, man. You speak up for the American people, man.
Thank you.
It's
really just myself I'm interested in, but go ahead.
Yeah. This is what you have to do. What you do is when you schedule an appointment with any of these companies, most of the time the call's recorded. You just let them know, if they're not there in that window, that you're contracting somebody there to wait there for you.
Mm-hmm.
So if they don't show up, you bill them for any additional time and short pay your invoice.
Well,
and it's completely legal.
All right, I understand that, but I think I called it a 6-hour window, an 8-hour window. They can, I mean, you can show up in an 8-hour window. It's not that they don't show up, it's that it takes them 8 hours to show up. And we've all been in that place, too, where it's like, it's 11:30, you want to go out and grab a sandwich, but you're panicked because you already have 3.5 hours invested into the waiting, and you're sure you do that thing. Just my luck, I run to the corner, go right through a drive-thru, and come right back. I'm gone for 11 minutes, and I know that van will pull up in that 11 minutes and keep driving. It'll be just my luck. You won't know it. You'll keep waiting out the rest of the day. Just that whole thing where you're in the shower and you think you hear the phone ring 5 hours in your vigil. As I said, an 8-hour window, really 8 hours. An appointment made 2 weeks in advance, you still need 8 hours. Everyone, all I'm saying is would that fly? Would it be acceptable? And would it work in the private sector? Would it work with competition? Would it work with a 5 more pages of companies that do exactly what you do in the phone book underneath yours? Answer, of course not. And that's what they do. That's why the government's evil, by the way. And that's why the nature of man is bad. It's lazy, it's sloppy, it's pathetic, and it's slow. And you have to wave dollars in front of people to get them not to give in to their nature. That's all. Mm-hmm. The only one who can't be swayed by money is Big Tad. He's the only pure human being I know. Doesn't matter whether he's getting paid or not. He's going to show up late. Kiss his ass. He can't be bought.
All my life, I've been an obese man trapped inside a fat man's body.
And you know what? I respect that, Tad. Takes moxie to show up late. Even though you got yelled at for being late the day before, screw the man. I'm showing up. Here's my work window. All right, now it is time for the news with Teresa Strasser.
An announcement from the Oval Office tonight. President Bush is expected to describe a plan in which thousands of National Guard troops will help patrol the Mexican border.
Yes.
Some politicians denounced this plan yesterday, saying our troops are already overtaxed by the war in Iraq.
Mm-hmm. Yes, put them at the border. Fine.
You're
so
for it.
What? Yes. How long can we absorb our neighboring nation's poorest people? How long do you think that'll work? And people do that thing. Hey, they're honest. Hey, they're hardworking. Yeah, they're honest. They're hardworking. They have 5 kids, and they don't put an emphasis on education, and we can no longer absorb that.
It's a 2,000-mile border.
And people want to say that's racist. I don't care if we're across from Germany, France, the Netherlands. It doesn't matter. We can't afford to take the poorest the rest of the world has to offer and all the kids and bring them over here. We can't.
Thank you.
The more you know. Go ahead, put them at the border. It's fine. What's the big deal?
Well,
is that a big deal?
They're upset because the National Guard, if some of them have had many tours of duty in Iraq, they're tired, they're overstretched.
Oh, yeah. Look, I don't want to put our guys through anything more, but as far as the message that it sends to the horrible Mexican government, so what? Kiss our white ass, corrupt retards over there. Why don't you get your society in order, and then we wouldn't have to do this. But believe me, you turning your nose up at us is you like when you pass a bum and he wants a quarter and you say screw off and he goes, puh. What, are we supposed to have our feelings hurt? When you guys sober up, call us and we'll talk.
Saddam Hussein's trial resumed today in Iraq. As always, he was reportedly angry and contentious on the stand. Here's some audio of that.
I am still the president of Iraq, and with the help of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I will be for many, many years.
Smart. A good angle.
He found the Lord.
Yeah, look, nobody goes to, look, you can't even go to a drunk tank for 10 minutes without finding Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm. What's weird is that Saddam Hussein sounds so much like Zacharias Moussaoui in that audio.
Mm. Yeah, he does. I don't want to stereotype, but a lot of the guys from that region have mustaches and dark hair. They sort of look alike, and they sound alike, too. No one, who do you Jews have? What do you got? Moses or Abraham? Who do you, no Jew finds anyone in the joint. Perhaps it's because no Jew's ever been to the joint.
Well, there's 6 Jews, probably.
But they're at those country club kind of places. You know, they're out on a lawn playing volleyball all day. And it's basically, look, there's no fences around this prison. You give us your word, you won't try to flee.
No problem.
That's my kind of prison, by the way. Who finds Judaism in the joint?
People who want kosher food. Actually, a guy wanted kosher food because it's better, and he converted to Judaism.
All right, but that was just a pissed off brother.
Well, it was one guy.
Okay.
All right. In entertainment news, Chris Daughtry fans are crying conspiracy, saying the American Idol contestant was wrongly booted from the show, though Idol producers have denied any voting irregularities. 30,000 fans signed an online petition demanding a recount, our own Big Tad, among those signing the petition on the internet.
That's why he's an American hero. That's he why is. He can't be bought. Signing
That's right.
a petition.
And by the way, Chris Daughtry on the show later today.
Hold on a second. Hey, listen, Big Tad.
He's
here's
on the
deal. Yes, he, Big Tad, don't come in. Just look at me through the glass here. I know we have a delay. This will get to you in a few moments. No more petition signing until you've saved up a cleaning deposit for an apartment, all right? That's the move. Once you have
fair.
The cleaning deposit saved up, then you can resume your petition signing campaign. Thank you.
Thank you. Tom Hanks has a big film coming out next week, The Da Vinci Code. Mm. Last night on the Actor's Studio, he told James Lipton just exactly how he's able to convey deep thoughts so well.
I'd like to think I'm aware of it, but I know that sometimes it happens quite by accident. That's what's amazing about films. You can go off and you can have a day where you think, man, I nailed that today. I was killer. I was ready. It was sensational. I acted really good today.
And?
You see it in the movie, and it's the worst thing you've ever
Nothing.
Seen. It's just...
It's ham. James Lipton, still for me, the heavyweight champ of all times in the blowhard department.
Sure.
Nobody can come close
no,
to his
I
legacy.
I agree with you, but let me tell you why I resent Hanks.
Why?
Hanks is beloved, you know, obviously, mm-hmm. in Hollywood and everything. But let me just say this. He acts like a bachelor party never happened. You ever
yes.
heard him talk about his old pictures? It's as though they don't exist.
Right.
That's your best picture, fella, in some of our book.
Yeah. Yes, your finest hour. I agree. The other thing that's weird is I was watching Tom Hanks' bio last night just before I went to bed. Had a kid in 1978, had another kid in like 82 or something.
They're, really?
Yeah, I know he has a son who acts, but it's yeah. just weird when Tom Hanks is walking around and there's a 28, 29-year-old adult male who would be almost a contemporary of ours just walking around. Hey, not Tom Hanks, that's my dad. It's just weird. I always think of celebrities, especially when they're in the prime of their careers, having a bunch of young children that can never understand what daddy really does. But it's weird having a guy who's near 30 walking around as,
yes.
as the Hankster son. Yes.
Okay. Now, this I found very interesting. Autograph collector.
Peter Scolari, by the
yes.
way. Peter Scolari from
yes.
Bosom Buddies
yes,
or
the
whatever.
Other guy.
The other one. Very bitter, as it turns out.
Oh,
as
every,
you would be, too.
Every Oscar night, he's drinking a fifth.
Oh,
kicking back,
yes.
watching Tom. Okay.
Oh, hell, that's just Golden Globes. Oscars breaks out a cake.
Autograph Collector Magazine came out with a list of the best and worst autograph signers. Mm-hmm. You know how gracious they are. And I was surprised Johnny Depp is the most gracious autograph signer and the worst. Not because she just says, I'm not going to sign for you, but she also then gives them a lecture on how autographs are stupid. Cameron Diaz.
Ooh. Thought you were going to say Jane Mansfield.
No.
She never does anything.
How are you with signing autographs?
I have no problem about it, but I go from zero to the biggest a-hole you've ever seen after just a couple of quick insults. I've done it many times, and I realize the people go home and they twist the story, and I seem like an a-hole, and I don't care. I've done a million.
What do you mean insults?
Yeah.
Well, I do. I've had this happen a few times. Heavy set woman wearing the sweatpants who's clearly here visiting on vacation from Indiana. Oh, hey, it's the guy from the Man Show. Could I have a picture with you? Yeah, sure, no problem. Connie, take a picture. They always have to yell at their friend, too, about how, you pushed a big, it's the big butt. No, Connie, sweetie, push it. And then we start yelling. I realize people need to know how to work their friends' cameras. Or if you're friends and you vacation a lot together, get the same goddamn camera. Then it'll be yours, because the person's always, they get different cameras, and then the one person's like, honey, no, it's on top. And you're standing there with your arm around this sweaty moose. Honey, sweetie, it's the big button. It's the big button. No, sweetie, hold on. Come here. Sweetie, come here. And then they do the thing, and they show them, and then they walk back again. But how is the person supposed to know how to work someone else's
right.
camera anyway? Anyway, they do that thing where it's like, so I'm a big fan. My husband's a big fan of yours. My husband, I don't watch your show often, but my husband, he's going to love. Hi, Connie, it's the big button. Is it ever the small button? It's just a big button. And so I don't. And then that sort of turns into, I don't care for the show. And then that turns into, I don't care for that kind of humor. And it's that point I remove my arm and go, hit the bricks, cow. And the person's like, what? We didn't get a picture. That's right. We're not getting a picture either. I don't understand. I don't. Listen, sweetie, I took the first two insults just fine. If you just shut your fat cake hole, I wouldn't have walked away. But the third one about you not caring for that brand of humor, now I'm gone. But my husband, yes, look, he's married to you. He's got bigger fish to fry than not having Connie take a picture of me with my arm around a manatee. Fine, I'm moving on. And now I realize they think I'm a huge a-hole. But look, come up, be nice, you get whatever you want. Start with the subtle insults, hit the bricks, fatty.
And now I'm signing off. I'm Teresa Strasser, and that's the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
People were going gaga last night at the Staples Center. Did you watch the big game?
Mm-mm.
Clippers defeated the Suns 114-107. Elton Brand with 30. Sam Cassell with 28 big ones, clutch ones, too. Corey Maggette, 18. Series now tied at 2. They're traveling to the Valley of the Sun tomorrow night.
Mm.
Tied up, big game 5 it shall be.
By the way, that's what Teresa calls her private part.
What's
Valley
this?
Of the Sun.
The Valley of the Sun, because why?
Formerly Chavez Ravine. Now switch to Valley of the Sun.
Well, I hope the Clippers have a good time there.
I would like to say this about the Staples Center crowd.
Yes.
Last night, I'm watching the game, and the place is filled with red and blue t-shirts. Entire stadium going wild and everything. I just want to say something. I don't want to, bring down ticket sales. I'm sure the stadium's going to fill up no matter what. Mm-hmm. The arena's going to fill up. But to all of you people in Los Angeles walking around proudly in your red and blue shirts and hanging the little flags from your cars where last week purple and gold ones flew.
Yes.
Shame on you.
Of course.
Shame! Let me tell you something.
Report.
Billy Crystal, Frankie Muniz, and about 7 other people cared about this team 6 weeks ago. You don't now get to latch on and suddenly make them your team.
I don't even count Frankie Muniz either because the guy is 19 and a half. I mean, how much pain has he seen? He got on board when what? He was if it was in the 11th grade. Still, it's only 3-4 years.
Hear, hear. All you are front runners. You should feel great shame.
Mm-hmm.
Take a long look in the mirror. What are you about?
That's right. Yes.
That's right.
Click.
Now, Major League Baseball, our national pastime, yesterday did a nice thing in honor of trying to remind everyone that early detection is the key with breast cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So all the ball players were encouraged to use pink bats.
Pink bat is the name of my genitalia. Call it the pink bat. I also call it the pink fungo.
Almost all of them wore pink wristbands, and a lot of them swung the pink bats with varying degrees of success.
Choking up on them.
Sure.
Here's my question. I mean, it looked odd when you saw it. It looked like there was something wrong with the tint on your TV or something.
Mm-hmm.
You go, oh, it's a pink bat. Here's my question. What jerk refuses to use the pink bat? Listen. If you need instruction that you need to go to the doctor and get mm-hmm. tested for the breast detection, all this sort of thing, so be it. Then that's a shame that you need a ball player to hold a pink bat to do it. But if that's the way it works, so be it. What jerk says no? No, I'm too macho.
The only thing I can think of is Major League Baseball players are very superstitious,
right?
Because you will get superstitious if your goddamn season is 9 months long and you spend the majority of it eating sunflower seeds and sitting on a bench. You start inventing rally hats. You start rubbing. You give people enough time alone in a holding cell and they start acting weird, and that's what happens. Football players don't have that because they're constantly moving. Basketball players don't have it either. Baseball players spend an hour at a time just sitting on the bench. They get into their bat, they get weird, they get superstitious, or they cork it, and that's the only thing I can think of.
Well, I say shame on them as well.
All right.
I'm throwing out people. I'm telling people today, look in the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
Feel shame if it's makes sense for you to feel shame.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, the winners yesterday from our pastime, Dodgers, Oakland, the Snakes of Arizona, and the first place Padres, the teams that lost, the Halos. They're 6 games under.
Uh-oh.
You make stuff about, like, oh, the season. 6 games under. They're starting to dig themselves a hole they're not going to get out of.
Right.
And the Giants, the good news from that is, bury the creep Bonds. No home runs. He's stuck on 713. He was expected to break the record, Babe Ruth's record at least, in front of the home crowd. Now he's got to go to Houston. He's going to be booed. Hit a home run, and everyone's going to boo. I'm going to love it, too. Speaking of boo, Stanley Cup playoffs last night, the San Jose faithful. In the Sharks and Edmonton game before that, they played Old Canada, Edmonton Oilers. They played for the visitors from the north.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
The crowd booed.
It's almost like I can hear it. Yeah.
Everyone booed the national anthem of Canada.
Really?
Don't we have enough troubles, America?
Wow.
Aren't we hated enough? Now our neighbors to the north must hate us as well?
Yeah, I think they hate us already. But maybe they're just booing the team and that represented the team.
So be it.
All right.
Shame on them just the same.
All right.
Shame is the theme.
Yes.
And to close it out, now my shame.
Mm-mm.
Now, here's what happened last night. The Sharks, they lost on Friday night. They were up 2-0 in the series.
Yes.
Chichu and company.
I know.
On a head-on collision course with Teemu Selanne and company, the Anaheim Ducks.
Mm-hmm.
Sharks lost Friday night. Last night, they lost 6-3. Chichu did his part. He scored a third period goal. However, they came up short. Now, the Sharks are on the cusp of elimination. They're down 3-2. They play again Wednesday night, maybe just as well. Because if Chichu and Teemu play, for whom shall I root? It would be too tough a
Sophie's
call.
Sophie's choice.
Mm-hmm. I don't know how to decide, Chichu or Teemu.
Slap of puck and twist of skate. On a sheet of ice, I watch you play. And I wait for Chichu. Chichu or Teemu?
Oh, no.
Chichu or Teemu? I can't choose. Chichu.
Wow.
Are
you in love with Johnny Cakes?
I've really carved out quite a hobby for myself, haven't I?
Yes. Take that into your next career. Ron?
Hey, Adam, how you doing?
Wait a minute. You're going to tell us. I don't want to hear from you, actually. Hold on a second. I wanted to talk to Eric. Eric?
Hey, Adam. How you doing?
Yeah. You can tell us how you can get by on this window or why it exists?
Yeah, why it exists. They can guarantee you a date, but they leave it up to the employee. They say, "Well, okay, here's 10 addresses you got to hook the cable up at." They're going to let him do them however he wants, whatever order he wants.
Yes, we're talking about the crazy 8-hour windows, the phone company, the cable company that everyone needs. Yes,
you got to keep the employee happy, so you don't tell him where he starts out and where he ends.
Look,
about keep the customer happy?
How about keeping the customer happy? And I know they play fast and loose, so they play slow and loose over there. But again, as I've asked the people when they tell me they need the 8 or 10 hour window, I ask them, do you write stuff down? Do you have one of those little books with dates on it where you put little stuff and pencil stuff in like other companies do? Maybe they were insulted and add another 4 hours. All right, play the end of sports. I know Sheck feels naked without it.
Dave Damashek's number one sports
ace. I want to let you know too, by the way, that I've got a special song for you. I think a Chichu Teemu song. It was inspired by you, your favorite band of all time.
I wait with anticipation. Speaking of anticipation, Ozzy, the Ozman's coming in here with his review of the Poseidon Adventure, or just Poseidon, as they're calling it now. I saw it over the weekend as well, so I'll be able to weigh in. Also, let me just talk to our crazy guy for 1 second. Crazy guy?
Oh, yeah. So I what my latest in...
What did you think of the Chichu Teemu song?
Exactly what it is. Yeah, that's what I was idiocentric in.
Mm-hmm. Did you enjoy it?
You're not actually saying that if I had a long extended period, I would turn into as interesting as the show's adapting to the current music, what happened to Westinghouse.
Thank you. I do it for the people, so yes. I appreciate your comment.
Hang on, crazy guy.
We're in Pittsburgh.
All right.
Oh, he knows right. a little bit about you.
Can you prove to me you're not crazy?
Yes. The wobble in seeing an American genius advertising for your show.
Mm-hmm.
It was, well, yeah, but people should, it's in Pittsburgh.
Okay.
All right.
There's a genius insurance. All you need is Detroit.
Okay.
Cameo
Detroit. All right, hang on a second, crazy guy.
Okay.
All right. We'll take ourselves a quick break. Ozzy, Oswaldo Castillo, my faithful sidekick, is going to be in here, and he's going to give a movie review of Poseidon after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. If you're going to wake up with a strange, hairy man, it might as well be him.
Jeff Probst is here from Survivor.
It's Ass Kiss Rodeo.
Love your hat, Adam, by the way. It's a great hat.
I love sushi.
Sushi is maybe the best meal out there, unless there's something I haven't tried.
I hate sushi.
And then there are times when sushi goes through you and you think, why'd I just eat it?
I've heard enough. Where's the new celebrity belt?
Stick around. Headed your way, more on The Adam Carolla Show. I say Adam, and he says...
Adam.
I say Hoffman, and he says...
Osman.
Adam.
Adam.
Hoffman.
Osman.
That's just how Oswaldo talks. I say racist, and he says...
Racist.
I say confusion, and he says...
Confusion.
Racist.
Racist.
Confusion.
Confusion.
That's just how Oswaldo talks.
Mm-hmm. The great Ozzy in studio. Well, out of the last 5 days, I have not seen Ozzy one day. Saturday. Ozzy, use the microphone. Pull that microphone up to your bearded mouth, please.
I'm here.
How you doing, buddy? Did I see you on Saturday?
No.
No. Just Friday?
Friday.
And Sunday?
Sunday, yesterday.
Ozzy smoked some beautiful salmon and brought it over to the house yesterday. He was actually at my house when I got home yesterday.
Bringing a Mother's Day gift to your wife, no less.
Yes, he brought flowers to her, which at first glance, it'd be a very nice thing, except for the part where I didn't get her flowers, and now I look like a bigger turd than I normally am. Yes, Ozzy got nothing to say about that. Ozzy, who did you bring flowers to yesterday?
To, you know, little friend, you know, mother friend. You know.
Did you bring it to Lynette's mom?
Yep.
My wife's mother brought flowers to.
Sweet.
Brought to my wife. My wife.
West Valley.
Who? Oh, yeah. It's not close either. Who else? Anybody else?
To Gina.
Jimmy's wife. Jimmy's ex-wife.
Wow.
Who else? How about people I dated in high school?
My mother, my mm-hmm. wife.
Mm-hmm. What,
you couple the lady, you know, Armenian lady, old ladies.
Sure.
Random Armenian old ladies or
neighbors?
Greg, yeah, neighbor.
Ozzy, I'll tell you what. Next time you want to give some flowers to my wife... Drop them off to the Ace Man, quietly, and I'll make sure she got them. And don't worry, I'll say they're from you. But don't ask her about it.
No worry.
Okay.
I know coming in. I living out.
So you saw the Poseidon Adventure.
But wait a second. You owe Carolla, you owe him $5,000. How much did all these flowers cost?
No, he does not owe me $5,000.
Oh, he's working it off, right?
He owes me $4,900, wait a minute. Oh, $150. $850.
Yeah.
Pay me.
$850.
Yeah, right.
I'm ready.
You're a wonderful man. You really are. That's very sweet.
All right, so Ozzy's got a review of Poseidon. I have my own review. I'll tell you what I think before we get to Ozzy's, or do you want to do it the other way around? I don't want to spoil it for everyone. Ozzy, give me your take on the Poseidon, and then I'll give my review.
Okay.
Oswaldo, tell us about some movies. We want to know which movies you have seen.
morning. The movie that I saw and reviewed today is Poseidon.
Mm-hmm.
It's a star, Josh Lucas.
Josh.
It's Dylan Jones.
It's who?
Dylan Jones.
Dylan Jones?
Dylan Jones.
Mm-hmm.
Kurt Russell. It's Robert Renzi.
Kukaroo?
Kurt Russell.
All I heard was the rolling of an R. All I heard was... Sound like you're trying to start a moped.
I have some problem to my throat right now, you know.
Sorry, buddy. All right, so Kurt Russell.
Kurt Russell.
Mm-hmm.
It's Robert Ramsey.
Wow. Kurt Russell and Robert Ramsey. Oh, as Robert Ramsey, yes.
Jacinda mm-hmm. Barrett is mm-hmm. Maggie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Maggie is the mother, you know, to the child.
Yeah, Jacinda Barrett. She was in that Ladder 42 or whatever that John Travolta was.
Also in the
was.
Real world, London.
That's right. All right.
Jim Richard Dreyfuss is Richard Nelson.
Richard Dreyfuss, yes.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You know, the old guy making, you know, the paper, you know, to the almost, you know, the homosexual guy, you know, no receipt call to the guy.
Old Queen, I think.
Yeah.
They put an earring. All they do, if they want to make you gay, they give you nice frames on your glasses and put an earring in one of your ears, and all of a sudden you're gay. Yeah. Right.
Poseidon.
We gotta get Brusca an earring then.
Right.
Oh my God.
Go ahead.
Poseidon is a film in the history based in the bestseller to the same name, Poseidon.
Mm-hmm.
It's about a luxury transatlantic vacation ship over the North Atlantic Ocean with almost 3,000 passengers.
3,000 passengers?
Yeah, passengers.
Why 3,000?
I see, you know, 3 in the front and 1,000 in the back, you know, 3,000 counting.
As he wanted to try a joke, that was it. Told me to ask him why 3,000.
What was the joke?
I'm not sure. If you have to ask why, you can't afford the joke.
No rear view mirrors, Teresa.
I'm sorry, please. Moving forward.
Yeah. The movie is about a small group of survivors.
Mm-hmm.
They had to fight to their life.
Mm-hmm.
The group start with 8 people and finish with only six people.
Mm-hmm.
5 adults and 1 child.
Mm-hmm.
I saw in the field too many lies.
A lot of lies. Mm-hmm.
When you see somebody pushing with the water, 1,000 gallons of water, you know, and one lobby and one ship, mm-hmm. and nobody happy, you know. No scratch, no damage in the skin.
Yeah, they always get a little cut above their eyebrow, but it just makes them look tough.
But otherwise, there were a lot of things that happened in the picture that rang false for you.
So, it's BS. Yeah. My favorite part, you know, one when Dylan Jones,
mm-hmm.
played by Josh Lucas,
mm-hmm.
uses the fire hose to swing over the water, you know, with the fire.
Mm-hmm.
And he taking, you know, the hose, you know, for taking the other side. You see this part?
Yes, I did.
It's lying.
Did you see that part?
No, I was making a kiki. But in the VIP section of the Egyptian, you can do it right and do a butler's hand.
Oh, God, yes.
Yeah, it's really nice. He cups his hand and you make a kiki, so you don't have to miss any of the movie.
In the end, the Poseidon... Poseidon left this reviewer cold.
Oh, no, Ozzy. Yeah, there was that scene, they keep showing it in the clips on the commercials where Josh Lucas gets the fire hose. And by the way, has a fire hose ever been used in a movie to actually put out a fire? It's always been used. I'll lower you down on this. We'll use it as an escape line. We'll tie up you. And it's never. No one's ever turned it on and said, how about we just use it? As a matter of fact, when I build a building, I'm just going to put a goddamn rope in where the fire hose is. That way they don't have to wreck my nice fire hose.
Repelling wire. Yeah.
Yes, that's all. You want to repel? Here's some nice repelling cord. Use this instead of my beautiful fire hose, which is meant, by the way, for putting out fires. They he pulls the fire hose out. He's up on the 8th story. They're looking down. Now, he has to bridge the gap. He's got to clear a gap about 18 or 20 feet from one to the other. So what's he do? You've seen it in the commercial. He takes the fire hose, and he just dives down into a fiery, debris-filled pit. and then comes up the other side, scales the thing, and hooks up the hose so they can use it like a zip line. Why not just throw the hose across the 18 feet? It's really the width of the studio. Be like, you have one end of the hose, take a little extra slack. All right, fellas, one, two, three, chuck it across. You string it up, and I'll slide across. You don't have to jump headfirst into a fiery, oily, debris-filled pool. And who does that? And by the way, nobody jumps headfirst into fire. If you think about it, you jump off your roof, it's foot first. You don't go head first. Takes the hose and does a swan dive into the thing. Ridiculous. The other thing is the rogue wave. They don't spend much time. As if a tidal wave just sort of moves along the ocean out in the open sea every couple of months. It doesn't exist. Now, they could have easily done it where they said, oh, we've had some seismic activity. There's been an earthquake off of Jakarta. You know, now we have seismic activity. Right. It was just a rogue wave. They didn't see it. They didn't talk about it. They're up in the bridge, and about 30 seconds before the wave hit the ship, which is tidal wave size, they said, oh my God, there's a huge wave. But nothing showing up on the radar. No radio signals of any seismic activity. Why not just do that? Mm-hmm. Why not just say there was an earthquake an hour ago in Jakarta, and then you'll have the wave? It's as if this is a phenomenon that just exists all the time. Also, Kevin Dillon's character was just laughable. And anytime, and here's my advice to anyone listening, if you get yourself into a scrape where you're trapped in a building or trapped in a boat and somebody's trying to lead you to safety, button your lip. Don't start popping off. Don't do anyone who says, hey, listen, buddy, you're not the captain of the football team anymore. You're dead. You're going to get hit with an I-beam in the next 10 minutes. Believe me. Don't pop off. Don't tell anyone they're not the captain of the team or they're not in the... Kurt Russell was the former mayor of New York. Of course, Dylan had to tell him, you're not the mayor anymore. Of course, you're dead. Also, don't take a nip from a flask. That means you're going to. If you get a little nip for yourself, or you try to scurry away like any food or water, keep it away from the other people, you're dead meat. And the other thing, if you pop off at all, or if you're greedy at all, you know, where someone says, listen, leave the Rolex behind. Oh, no, you're dead. So don't try to keep anything, money, jewelry, possessions. Don't pop off, and certainly don't tell anyone they're not the fill in the blank anymore.
Overall, did it leave you cold? It was
a horrible movie. But if you're like me and you want to see what $160 million right. bucks looks like squeezed in to, by the way, like an hour and 28 minutes, you'll watch.
Well, that's why I feel bad for you. This was the movie you were so excited about.
I was
this was the
about
summer
it.
Blockbuster, and now your summer is downhill from here. And this was the big one for me. I saw Mission Impossible. That was just a little hors d'oeuvre. I liked it, and I still have the X-Men as the main course.
Yeah, it's going to be great, and
it
it's lovely. It's lovely to see Halle Berry accept one of her diversity awards and explain that's why people love the X-Men, because of the diversity.
Oh, by the way, Halle Berry,
would you please just go away?
She made it onto the worst autograph signer. List, Halle Berry, not surprising.
Oh, what a coos. Yeah, that's what we like. Yeah, because the guy who can turn himself into a ball of fire, who does he represent? Latinos? Who represents the lesbians? Is that the Mr. Stretch guy or Wolverine? Jesus Christ, shut up.
Yeah, let's not overthink it.
Oh, my God. And another thing, too, that Halle Berry does every time she gets interviewed and everyone just nods their head like a retarded bobblehead is she explains. And it's one of these things where she needs to have a tube that goes from her mouth to her ass so she can just blow a continuous wind right up her tukai, because she does this thing where, you know, my career has gone great considering what I've had to overcome. This sort of thing, and we all just buy into it. Yeah, Halle Berry, boy, all she's had to overcome being half black, all because of the society, the racist society we live in. She's had to overcome so much, and it implies, think how great she is. She started with a handicap and has overcome that. Now, it's one thing, if you're a boxer who has one arm and you make it to heavyweight champ, you've overcome adversity. Right. If you're a smoking, piping, hot chick like Halle Berry, you've overcome nothing. The fact that you're half black pales in comparison to being smoking hot. Ugly chicks, there's adversity.
Yeah.
Being number one at the box office as a female and being an ugly troll, that's overcoming adversity. having a flat, pushed-in face and a huge, wide ass and being number one at the box office. You'll never see that, by the way. But if anyone ever does that, that's adversity. Yes, if overcoming adversity. If Cameron Manheim becomes number one at the box office, that's overcoming adversity. Being piping hot and half black isn't. But I love the fact that you have to keep repeating that familiar refrain so everyone thinks you're even better. Boy, imagine how good. Imagine if she was white and society gave her a break. Imagine where she'd be. Yeah, she'd be president right now of more than one country. Canada and the United States, and maybe Mexico.
There's no racial bigotry here.
Please shut your fat trap. Just go make your money in your silly fantasy movies and go away. Please.
I'm sure one day she's had an enlarged pore or something like that and had to still push through.
She's overcome so much. So tough. All right, we'll take a quick break. Who's up? Oh, we have our drunken tree mascot. Jesus.
Billy's worried.
Oh, Billy's up next, and then our drunken tree mascot. Billy's made a decision. He's our 17-year-old webmaster. Prom season.
He's had three lovely ladies to choose from. He's been interviewing them for the last hour.
I know.
He's going to eliminate one.
Right. All right.
It's a great show. A lot of fun.
Take a quick break. We'll be right back with Billy after this.
The Adam Carolla Show, where everyone's entitled to Adam's opinion.
I absolutely refuse to attend one of these sexual harassment meetings. The next time your company asks you to do this, say no. I'm not going to do it. I have work to do. And then go into the bathroom and masturbate. That's what I do.
If you keep listening, he'll keep talking. The Adam Carolla Show.
Billy goes to Buena Vista High School. It's prom season. You need a date.
Yeah, by May 20th.
I have a phone number of one of the girls here.
Unfortunately, the person who gave you this number does not want to talk to you or speak to you ever again. We would like to take this opportunity to officially reject you.
Sad. Sad but true. Billy here, our webmaster.
Yeah.
Looking good, buddy.
Thank you. You too.
17. Thank you, Billy. He's a big fan, so I'm a fan of his.
Yeah.
That's the way it works.
Billy went out with me. He got his hair cut real short.
Looking good.
Like Brad Pitt in, I don't know what. Nice and short, though.
You're looking sharp. Prom season upon us. Billy's prom this Saturday.
Yeah, May 20th.
Looking for a date. We have Melinda, Shannon, and Nicole in here. Melinda, 17, but still a sophomore over at Monrovia High School. Lives with her sister in Monrovia, yes?
No, I live with my mom.
I got you two screwed up. Right, but what sort of abuse have you suffered? Are you okay? Everything's good with you?
Yeah, I'm fine now.
All right, Shannon is our 19-year-old. She's a freshman over at Saddleback Junior College. She's a cake decorator.
Yep.
All right, and needs a lozenge, yes?
What?
Vocally resembles Chewbacca quite a bit.
Yeah.
Bronchitis.
Well, she has bronchitis. Is it? Would you be over it by the prom?
My voice, yeah, but I really don't know. I'm on antibiotics. I've been on antibiotics all week.
Okay. Wookieitis.
And we have Nicole, who's 17. Got a job with Baskin Robbins, so that's a plus. And she's the one who lives with her sister.
Yes, that's
right. She's your legal guardian.
Uh-huh.
Shannon, I don't know if I want to get into this or not, but you told us you had a hobo power story.
Yeah.
During the break?
Uh-huh.
What was that hobo power story?
Actually, my mom died in February, and I'm the next of kin. She had killed herself.
Ooh.
To say the least.
It's getting very depressing.
Yeah, it's depressing, but I'm, you know, if it's something, I wasn't really that
close
to my mom.
It has been 3 months.
You weren't close to her.
Yeah, I wasn't really that close to her, but
she didn't raise you?
No, she didn't raise me. I was raised by my dad.
Your dad?
My whole life.
So you hadn't seen your mom since you were very young.
I'd seen her when she wanted to see me. So.
Right. She was depressed.
Yeah, she's an alcoholic. Well, I was the next of kin.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what it's called.
Right.
And
you had to identify.
Yeah, I had to go to her apartment and clean it out.
Oh.
And when I had got there, she was there for a week or so after she died.
Oh.
And so there was like poo everywhere and barf. And then, like, it was just
sweet hell. What kind of story?
Shannon, is this
a depressing one?
This is a true story.
Wow.
I was like, oh.
Now, yeah, but the good news is, if there's any good news from this story, is you were raised by your father.
I was raised by my father, and I'm doing very well, so.
All right.
Yes.
I'm put together very well.
All right. So, Billy, have fun cutting Shannon now, by the way. You're going to narrow the group down to three, down to two, yes?
I am.
We'll go from three to two, and then you'll make a final decision.
Well, before you make the cut, maybe this will influence your decision. How many of you, if maybe it's all of you, how many of you have Billy-itis? Who's got it bad for Billy?
Hold on, Brian, put your hand down.
Let's see a show of hands.
Just from the girls.
Everybody likes Billy?
Yes.
Everyone likes Billy.
Everyone's into Billy.
Romantically, you could see something, at least the bud is there that it could grow into romance.
Possibly.
Shannon?
You're attracted to him physically.
Melinda?
He's really nice.
All three say that they find him attractive. All right, Billy, that makes your decision that much more difficult.
Yeah, although it's bad when you focus on the physical and they go back to the personality stuff. Like, don't you think Dave's hot? No, he's really funny. Don't you think he's a handsome man? He's really nice.
Great guy.
Look at him. He's built like a brick ass house. He's funny.
Sweet.
Yeah, when he's sweet, he's sweet. Yeah, when you try to bring it into the realm of the physical and they keep going back to personality traits, that's
trouble.
That's bad. Yeah, what you want is the opposite. What you want, like you go, don't you think Dave's clever? I don't know. He's hunky. Hot. He's hot.
I can't even focus on how clever he is.
Yeah, in fact, you want women who don't really know you to call you a jerk.
That's right. All right, so what do you think, Billy? Can you narrow it down to two?
I can, but first, you know, I want to tell you a little bit about what I found out about Shannon.
Uh-huh.
She has four sisters, and she was raised by her dad.
Mm-hmm.
She went to nine different schools throughout her life.
Uh-huh, it means she's smart.
Yeah.
It's like when you have three jobs, it means you're rich.
She likes to party and hang out with friends, and she works at Stater Brothers, is that right?
That's where I decorate cakes, yes.
Oh, really? At the market, okay.
And she's 19 years old. Mm-hmm. I do have to say, the story that she told about her mom did really, it kind of freaked me out.
Freaked you out a little bit?
Yeah.
She's only 17.
And also, she told me that she is not single, that she has a boyfriend.
Oh.
Really?
Oh, Shannon.
How serious?
Shannon.
Shannon, does he know you're here?
Yeah.
He does.
He's very, very angry.
He is. Yeah, well, here's the thing. Billy doesn't need to have some angry pimp confront him in the parking structure, you know? All right, I'm just saying, he's got his whole life ahead of him.
Yeah.
All right, so with that...
So with that, Shannon, I'm going to have to say goodbye.
Shannon.
Sad but true. But look, you came in. You have a man already, Shannon.
Han Solo.
Yeah, I mean, come on.
Back to the Millennium Falcon with you.
And this will give her a chance to heal the chronic bronchitis.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, take the antibiotics and hang out with your man. Melinda and Nicole are now left. We haven't made a decision yet. No. Both hot, both single, both attractive. Yeah. We'll figure it out. We need to take a break. Yeah. Drunken Tree Mascot Girls coming in here. Also, Chris Daughtry, American Idol cast off, going to be on the show. Frank Vincent, Phil Leotardo from Sopranos still coming up. All that after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. If you can think of a better way to wake up, we'd like to hear it.
Big Tad went on a date last night. What base did Tad get to?
It was a really good makeout, maybe a little bit more, but that
bosoms.
That was that.
Little bosom. You felt Tad's bosom?
She
reached back, undid Tad's bra. One hand. No struggling.
If you keep listening, he'll keep talking. The Adam Carolla Show.
Let's go! Let's go!
Give me an A.
A.
Give me a D.
D.
What is it? Spell, though. Adam Carolla.
She got drunk in her costume. She smells like a bar room. Kicked out of Stanford. Drunk tree mascot.
I think I'm going to need a bucket.
She's completely loaded. Her beer gut is bloated. She'll screw you for a quarter. Drunk tree mascot.
Champagne makes me fart.
Yes, Aaron, drunken tree mascot. Now, again, for those who just tuned in to the show, actual mascot over at Stanford in the tree, got thrown out of Stanford, or at least the mascotting business, because she was drunk inside her tree mascot. We needed a mascot on this show. We hired her on. Maybe a mistake.
Mixed results at best.
That's right.
But first off, I was buzzed. I wasn't drunk. I was buzzed.
You just had a buzz in your tree outfit.
It's still probably not appropriate at a college basketball game to be drunk and interacting with children.
You represent the university, you understand?
I've said this before and I'll say it again. You can't get a cheer down with a tree arm. Right. You can't clap with it, and you can't dance to it.
Yeah, I guess it's sort of their fault. Did you not eat into the microphone?
Drunk tree, girl, are those two? Are you trying to soak up the alcohol with the pretzels?
Listen here, Rachel. You've gone through a lot of different looks.
It's Teresa.
And I haven't said anything.
That's Teresa.
What?
That's Teresa.
I'm not right. I'm a new girl.
She's new.
You're a new girl.
Yeah.
She's the new news girl.
Oh, great. Competition.
Well, we still think you're foxy.
Speaking of which, you changed your hair. You got a whole new hair color and everything.
I slept on the side of a 7-Eleven yesterday.
How'd that happen?
Well, I don't know, but it's not my baby.
Oh, I see.
It kicks like one, but it's not.
Well, listen, Aaron, we asked you to sober up just a little bit, sort of get your composure. Put your work hat on and come and be our mascot. You show up, you're sort of unkempt, you're drunk, you're belligerent, you're getting into it with Brusca all the time.
Brisket!
Yeah, you're calling Brusca Brisket.
I have songs about him.
Oh, really?
You know, because he's trying to make me do these cheers every time, and I think I'm more of an American Idol.
Well, let's hear the songs you have all about producer Brisket.
Put your beard down for
Give it to me louder.
He's drinking a beer.
Yeah, shouldn't be drinking at 8:30 in the morning.
Brisket. Not skinny like a Trisket. Fat. And hairy like an armpit. Brisket. He's a piggy Brisket. Don't kiss me there. Oh my God, your lips have hair. And you're just like a piggy. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Yoink oink like a piggy. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Brisket.
Yeah. Hey, your segment's over.
Why, well, listen, drunken tree mash guy's
over,
girl.
I gave you an opportunity. This is
I give you an opportunity for a jar of pickles. Copper roll, go in circles in the copper roll.
I'm not sure if the strategy of making fun of the producer of the program is a great strategy for someone who's hanging by a thread.
Hanging by a thread?
Yeah, you've been in here eight
this
or nine times.
This is a double support bra with metal strappings.
No, I don't mean...
Boobies!
I don't mean your boobies. I mean, you're hanging... We've asked you to sober up. We've asked you to fly right. We've asked you to learn some cheers and go out
then
and
promote the show in a positive way.
The show.
Cheer about the show.
Cheer about the show, and you show up drunk.
With
you're
spirits.
Belligerent.
He's getting upset.
You've been pulling all nighters. I'm sorry. It's time for tough love.
Time for tough love.
Yes, okay. It's time. It's like this has turned into an intervention. I'm sorry. We care about you, but we care about you
How
too much.
How dare you? How dare you insult me in front of Teresa Strusser? Or whatever her name is.
Teresa
I've seen
Strasser.
You eyeball me, baby, and I'll take you out with a punching glove. And a spray can of kick ass.
Don't worry, Brusca will defend me.
All right, look, maybe we should take a break and let you regain your composure.
Maybe.
Yeah, we have Chris Daughtry still calling in the show. The Ed has to do his Desperate Housewives review. Frank Vincent, Phil Leotardo from The Sopranos. I think we should probably cut our losses and move
Adam
on.
Adam Carolla.
I think we'll cut our losses and move on.
Dude, why don't we cut Brisket?
All right, look.
I don't know.
Let's take a look.
I got nothing. Let's try to be it.
Let's just take a break.
Toad the gay sprocket.
Show the drunken tree mascot the door, if you would, Brisket. Let's get her out of here.
I Brisket. Play field hockey. Show. I can go all night.
Push her out the door. Tad, we need you for backup here. All right, we'll be right back after this.
Sadly, this will be the best part of your day. The Adam Carolla Show.
Fast food is one thing that has not gone up in price at all. Everything was a buck when I was a kid, and gas was 75 cents, and now it remains a buck, and gas is $4.
Hey, everyone's entitled to Adam's opinion. The Adam Carolla Show.
He's a funny brother, this man of color. He's got 5 sons from 4 different mothers. The things he says will mess with your head. From Vegas, he's the Ed.
What did he?
That is the Ed. He has his Desperate Housewives review. I want to speak to Matt real quick before we speak to the Ed. Matt?
Yeah. How you doing, Adam?
What's happening, Matt? Hold on. Drunken tree girl mascot.
Hey! I
thought she was removed from the building, Brusco.
59, dude!
Yeah, your segment's over.
Your segment's a jar of pickles.
All right, don't make fun of Brisket anymore than he gets made fun of already. Brisket, see her to the door, please. We need to move on with the show.
Come on, she's crying again.
Get away from me!
I told you full time.
Listen, don't cry. Look, everyone here loves you.
Bart told me that pomegranate margaritas were going to help with my farting, but they didn't. They only made it worse.
Okay,
they
look,
did.
This is a point. We love you too much to see you go on this way. It's really pathetic to see you cry. Just
the new roasted panino. What do you care about? You just care about your ads.
Look, I got to do
fresh and hot from Subway.
I know. I got to do those Quiznos spots.
It's what
keeps the power turned on here at the station.
I'm sorry,
Brisket. Do me a favor. Walk Aaron, drunken tree girl mascot, out.
Listen,
we need to move on with the show.
I understand that, you know, every time you're going to hear you want to kick me out, and I think I've found the love of my life out there, and I heard you had a prom is coming up, mm-hmm. and I wanted to be there with you, Bill.
Oh, you want to go with Billy to the prom?
Yeah, Billy!
Yeah, I don't know if that's the statement he wants to make to his other classmates.
No. What?!
Well, I mean, look, no offense. You're heavy set. You're drunk. You're belligerent. I just feel like Billy's 17. He's at the prime of his life. You've made your mistakes already.
You know what I feel like? Mm-hmm. If you care. I feel like a woman who has played field hockey long enough to be muscular enough to show him the ways of the world.
All right. Yeah, that's everything. I don't want you breaking his pelvis with your animated sex acts. Billy's pure. He's a virgin. He should be with a petite little flower.
Yeah.
That's all. Not a big tumbleweed.
I'll bring my friends.
No. I can only imagine what your friends are like. Look, Aaron,
I have
Brisket. Show Aaron out, would you please?
I want to do a cheer for him first.
All right, quickly.
Okay, here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, Billy!
No, come on!
I would.
You can't use that kind of profanity. Get Aaron out of here,
flagellating
please.
A teenage boy.
Yes.
Shame on you.
Yes,
I have to be.
Show her the door, please.
What? Get out of here, you
that
little
was
chubby little pig magnet! You don't leave. Get off of me! You grab my boobs!
You can't help it, though. You're all boobs.
Yeah.
Matt?
Yeah, how you doing,
I'm
bud?
Sorry for that. You say you saw an odd license plate?
Oh, yeah. I was driving behind a brand new SL500, and the guy's license plate said, "Give to God."
Mm. Yes, he's driving 90
and the
grand.
And guy faintly resembled Benny Hinn.
Worth of Mercedes.
It probably was Benny Hinn. He does. He is known for extravagance.
Well,
he says it shows the glory of God. That's what he says.
Did he have a crazy orange comb over?
You know, I couldn't get that close to him.
All right. I love...
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I just love the fact that guys that do the healing and the preaching have the most exotic hair I've ever seen in my life. That, to me, is a strike. When I see someone with crazy hair, I think crazy. But if they're stand-up, I'll cut them some slack. If they're talking about the Lord, if they're sharing the good news, and they have crazy hair, now we're out.
Oh, yeah, I got one more funny thing to tell you.
Yeah.
I'm trying to be Jewish just like you. See, I'm an Irish-Mexican. Mm-hmm. So what I did was I found me a redheaded, fair-skinned, blue-eyed Jewish girl.
Mm-hmm.
And they I'm going to
mm-hmm. Smart.
Now, does this help me with being closer to what I consider the Jewish God?
Well,
I'm trying to save money.
Neil Diamond?
Yeah. All right. I have no idea. I can't answer such complex religious questions. One thing I do know is that we have the Ed on the phone. Ed?
Hello.
Ed, quickly, because we're really running late this morning. You have a review of the Desperate Housewives program?
Yeah, and I wanted to make sure you give me a good seat tomorrow because I'm coming to your show.
Oh, you are? You're going to be here in the flesh.
Wow.
Great. Yeah, I'm going to meet you. I'm going to touch your hands.
Fantastic. How about you just touch one of them?
Okay.
And you bring some Purell or whatever you call it.
I'm bringing some chicken wings for everybody.
Fantastic. We can't get them out here in California.
Yeah, they got them out here, though.
All right. What do you got for us, Ed?
Well, last night, the Gabriella and her husband are in a fight because the Gabriella is treating the pregnant maid better than his wife, and she's upset about it.
Mm-hmm.
Then the redhead lady, you know, she got rid of her homo son.
Mm-hmm.
She got a daughter now.
Mm-hmm.
It could be the son dressed up. I'm not sure yet. But now the daughter has ran away with the black boy. That lived with the black lady across the street that killed the other black boy.
Mm.
It's kind of confusing.
Yeah, it's really getting layered over there.
And then Lois, her house burned down, and her husband's girlfriend did it.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, "Ha ha! I burned down your house. What can you do about it?" And Lois said, "I guess nothing." So then the girl got stung by a bunch of bumblebees, and her face is all mashed up now.
Wow.
So it looked like she did get something done to her.
Has the show lost a little momentum, or is it just me? I don't know if the ratings are down, or people just don't seem to be talking about it as much.
I think the ratings are down because next week they said is the last show. And it's another two-hour show, Adam. I don't know about these shows when they try to do this two-hour thing. It don't make no sense.
Yeah, I'd rather them be more like 35 minutes than 2 hours. Seems like they're going the other direction. You want to get me to watch, say we have a special new Desperate Housewives or whatever hour-long drama. This one's going to be 33 minutes.
Well,
I might tune in.
There's only one more ever, so
that's
like it's going to be closing shop on that show.
Well, they'll come back in the fall or some point. Don't worry about it.
I took my girlfriend for Mother's Day yesterday to dinner.
This is the young lady that lives across the way from you?
Yeah, we went to the Long John Silver's.
Nice.
We had that for the Mother's Day dinner.
You're talking about, talk about class. Bottomless bucket of fried shrimp for Mother's Day.
So you two are back on because last time we talked, you'd broken up.
We talked about it and she made up with me.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, nice.
She knows. I mean, she knows I'm a good guy, and I know she's a good girl.
Mm-hmm.
You guys got a new girl there, huh?
Yes.
What's her name?
Teresa.
Hello, Teresa.
Hi. Oh, okay. I enjoy your reviews very much.
I like your news. You got some good news for me.
Thank you.
Now, listen, Ed.
Laying the groundwork.
Yeah, you're spoken for. You're dating someone. You just took a lady to Long John Silver's.
Well, I mean, I can talk to people.
Right, I understand. You're doing a fine job.
Yeah.
All right, Ed, we need to take a break.
All right, you take your break. I got to go to the bathroom in a minute anyway.
Okay, well, this is what you call serendipity. We appreciate the review. We'll see you in the flesh. Impress the flesh tomorrow.
That's going to be great. I can't wait to see him.
Chris Daughtry is coming up next. Latest reject from American Idol, but arguably the best pipes of the group.
Yes.
Never seen people more surprised to see someone leave. We'll talk to him after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. News, sports, and so much more.
baseball great Pete Rose in studio.
He could have been the hit king without a bat. The
actually, that was Tony Perez.
Wow. Is that right?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, he wore three Shire shoes.
Holy cow!
We'll be right back with much more on the Adam Carolla Show.
We're caught in a trap. I can't walk out because I love you too much, baby.
Chris Daughtry.
Why can't you see?
American Idol, Chris Daughtry. A lot of people outraged. Feel he was hosed. Best pipes out of the four and yet voted off. I don't know why. Tad signed a petition.
Some people are saying conspiracy.
Well, 30,000 people signed a petition online, including Tad.
Yeah.
Is he on the phone right now?
Yes, he is.
Oh, God, I'm
nervous.
Yeah,
man.
Chris.
You finally got your wish. I'm on your show now.
Yeah.
Yeah, I ran into Chris in the hallway at CBS along with Ace and I can't remember who else was with us.
I saw Dr. Drew the other day at the Weenie Roast at K-Rock.
Oh, he did. Looks even better in person, doesn't he?
He does, man. It was great. I met him and his kids. Great family.
I ran into Chris, and I didn't know how to phrase it, but I basically said, if or when you get voted out, you can come on the show. You can't come on the show before, and I don't want you to get voted out, but if you do, come on down, and here he is.
Yes, I'm here.
A man of his word. So it must be nice in a way to have more uproar about you being voted off than anybody in the however many seasons, four or five seasons they've done it. And all these people are beloved. The fact that people are outraged over you being voted off must
definitely
feel...
showing me how much people really support me. And I'm just, I am blown away and overwhelmed by that. So it's definitely not a bad thing.
Yeah, I watch every week, and it's really, at this point, especially a coin toss. I mean,
It really is. It's hard to pick anybody at this point.
Yeah, you could make a pretty good case for everybody, and you could have made a good case for three or four people that are gone now, and certainly including Chris. So what is your suspicion about how it went down? How do you think it worked?
Well, I can tell you what a lot of people are telling me. Even some of the fans are saying, you know what, I'll confess to you, I thought you were in, and I didn't vote for you that night. Mm-hmm. And so, that could be multiplied by thousands. So,
right.
You know, if that was the case, so be it. You know, it's unfortunate, but things happen for a reason, and it could be the best thing.
Well, you wind up in a better situation than if you'd won this thing, right? You hooked up with fuel now.
Well, that's not necessarily the case. I mean, that's the rumor that I've already signed the contract.
Hold on, Dave, be quiet. You have to.
Got kicked off the show because I signed a record deal, and I'm already signed with Fuel, and we're going on tour this summer. No, it's all rumors, and I'm considering everything that comes my way because, you know, I got a family, and I got to make sure that whatever I decide is going to benefit us the most, and I never want to put us in a situation where it is not going to be the best thing.
Well, you have to. You're contractually obligated to go out on tour with the American Idol tour.
Tour in the summer, and
right.
We got about 40-some dates lined up, so I'm looking forward to that.
And that would be, was that the top 10 folks go out on tour?
Yeah, top 10.
And I imagine you sort of headline in order of appearance or in order of when you were.
That is the case. I think that is the case. And, of course, like the winner and the runner-up has a longer set.
Right.
But, hey, that's cool. I'll hopefully get a few songs to go out there and show what I do and maybe even stage dive and hopefully not land on the floor. And
well, then after that, if you wanted to take up with Fuel or take their offer, you could do it after you honored your contract with American Idol, right?
Well, I mean, technically, yes, but, you know, I'm really taking some time to consider everything, so.
Go solo.
But that's Big Tad who signed the petition.
But I got a band back at home, too, and hopefully I get to work with those guys. You know, who knows?
Well, they got to be PO'd. They know you're out of there. They're having their own mini American Idol to find the next lead singer for their band. But ultimately, you definitely got what you set out to get, which is exposure.
Absolutely. I mean, of course, when you enter the competition, that's all you want. When you get in the competition, you're like, man, I want to win this thing. And then when you're out of it, you're like, wait a minute, I got exactly what I came in here to do. So,
especially if you have a good product. I mean, if you have the pipes, if you can sing, and I think everyone was impressed by right. the way you sang, then the exposure you get leads you to success.
Yeah.
So you're set. You're good.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. And I'm glad that I got that response from people, because in the beginning, I didn't know that my style, even though Bo, you know, was doing rock and roll, and I was still worried that my harder, edgier rock and roll wouldn't be taken, you know, as well as it did. So the fact that it was handled and then accepted so well that far, just, you know, it was like, wow, that's awesome. So I didn't want to change anything. I didn't, you know, want to stick to my guns. And
who do you think may win, or who would you like to see win?
That's a tough question, dude, because they're like my brothers and sisters, you know. That'd almost be like favoring one or the other. And we, the whole time we were in the competition, we would honestly, afterwards, we'd get together and we'd all, like, vote for each other and vote for ourselves and throw a few votes around. So I'm probably going to keep doing that for those guys and throw them all a few votes, give them some love. I mean, they're my family, and you know, I'll be on the finale anyway, so.
I sort of think, I mean, it comes down to who you think is the most talented, but it also comes down to who you think could use it the most. You know, I mean, Catherine right. McPhee is set. She's beautiful. She's young.
Well, hopefully at this point, all of them are, you know. I mean, it's a, you know, like I said, even with me, hopefully everybody got the exposure they needed, and everybody will get what they want out of this whole project. So,
speaking of exposure, did Paula grope you at all?
Absolutely not.
Good.
Is Catherine hot in real life?
She's a beautiful person. She really is.
Mm. How about Ace Young? Is he hot in life?
He's a beautiful person.
How about Taylor?
He's a beautiful person.
If I put a gun to your head, who would you say wins? And again, your vote, I mean, doesn't count. It's not like it's from your mouth to God's ears or anything. But if I put a gun to your head and said, you got to pick one of the three, who do you pick?
Well, you don't want to hear my opinion, because I was wrong, you know, I was wrong before. So I can't say, honestly. I can't.
You really, nobody you'd like, guys, after spending all that time with them, nobody you'd like to win over the next?
Not really, because, I mean, I like them just as much. You know, at this time, it's more about, like, them being friends than talent, because, I mean, I like them all, so.
How about Elliot coming from nowhere?
I tell you what, that guy really just, it's almost like something went off in his head, and he's like, you know, he was going to give it his all, and he did, man. He's really, really shown a lot.
I got to say, around, you know, when the cut was down to, you know, 12, you thought Elliot was the next to go. At that point, the fact that he's made it to the final three is pretty amazing, but he's improved steadily throughout the competition.
Absolutely. Yeah, he was, he's a funny guy. You know, he was worried every week just because he just didn't think he had the fan base. So,
yeah.
But obviously, that's been proven wrong, and he's doing really well. And I think everybody at this point, whoever works the hardest and shows that they want it the most and just pours their heart and soul in everything they do is going to be the one to win it.
What is tomorrow's theme? I don't know what tomorrow night's theme is. Do you know? Did they tell us? Did they tell you?
Yeah, the three songs, like Clive Davis picks our song, the judges picks a song, and then the contestants picks a song of their choice. So
they're each doing three?
Three songs.
And how does it work, quickly before we let you go, how does it work in terms of clearing songs, if you just want to pick any song you want?
You basically, within the guidelines of the themes, you pick whatever song you want to do, and they submit it to the publishing company, and they clear it or not clear it. So.
Yeah, I was surprised to hear Beatles song on there.
One of the hardest groups for us to get cleared, but it was not owned by... it was owned by...
Jocko owned it,
Sony.
Probably. Yeah, Michael Jackson.
No, I think Harrison. Was it George Harrison?
Harrison's estate owned it.
Yeah, so I think that was the difference in getting that one cleared.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Did you have any turn down stuff you wanted to do?
I did have one turn down. It was I wanted to do Behind Blue Eyes by The Who. So
really?
Yeah. And
those guys have sold their entire catalog to every Pontiac commercial I see on TV. Really? You couldn't do Behind Blue Eyes, huh?
Yeah, I couldn't. So, you know, but I had good luck with mostly anything I wanted to get cleared. So
right.
I was really happy. A lot of people were picking, you know, there were some songs that just... you know, some people just didn't have luck with anything they wanted to do.
Yeah, that would have been good to see you do the Roger Daughtry up there. All right, Chris, thank you very much for being part of the show.
Maybe I can stop by sometime. And
that would be sweet. When you're in L.A., please come in and see us in the flesh.
You got it, man.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Chris Daughtry. Yeah, this would have been a good one for him, yeah.
Now what a treat I have coming for you now. Daughtry couldn't clear a Who song, but Damashek did.
Really?
That's right. In homage to Chichu and Tama.
That is going to be awesome. All right. That'll be coming up after Teresa's news, yes?
Correct.
Teresa, what is coming up in the news?
Well, actually, speaking of Idol, Paula Abdul said something rather shocking in the press. We're going to get into that. And Sopranos last night, Vito in a downward spiral.
Yeah.
And alligators on a killing spree in Florida.
All right. All that coming up on the news and another Temu Chichu number from one Dave Damashek. Enjoy it while he lasts after this.
Can't get enough? Check out Adam on the web at adamcarolla.com.
I never got past high school math, so I'm not sure what pi is exactly, but any equation that involves dessert, I'm in for.
Adam will never run out of opinions. The Adam Carolla Show.
Billy goes to Buena Vista High School. It's prom season. You need a date.
Yeah, by May 20th.
I have a phone number of one of the girls here.
Unfortunately, the person who gave you this number does not want to talk to you or speak to you ever again. We would like to take this opportunity to officially
phone screener Brian. Now sound effects. Man, Brian never gets tired of that joke.
It never gets old.
It never gets old for him. Perhaps he sees some of himself in young Billy.
Who doesn't? We all do.
Yes.
Do you have to play that over and over and over again?
Yes, we do. Billy's 17. He's our webmaster here. Shockingly, he doesn't have a prom date.
Yeah.
We brought in three ladies. We've narrowed it down to two. Melinda and Nicole left behind. Both attractive. Melinda is a 17-year-old sophomore. She was held back a grade or so over at Monrovia High School. And Nicole over here lives with her sister, legal guardian, and works at Baskin-Robbins.
Yes, that's right.
A plus. Billy?
Yeah?
You've had a chance to... I know you drifted
Billy's
off there for
over
a second.
Notes.
You had a chance to talk to the ladies one-on-one?
I did. I had a very interesting conversation. I got to learn a lot.
Billy, put the notes down.
Yes.
It's not about notes. It's about what's in the heart.
Speak from the shorts. from the heart. What did you think of the two ladies? Start with Melinda.
Melinda, she was very interesting. She's very nice, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I asked her the question that Brisket asked me to ask her.
What was the question Brisket told you to ask?
Maybe I shouldn't mention it on here.
Come on.
Is she a virgin?
Mm.
And, yeah, she is.
She is?
Yeah. No. She really is. Yeah.
All right.
A little about Melinda. She likes to hang out with her brothers and sisters. She goes to Monrovia High School.
Mm-hmm.
Her parents divorced when she was 3 or 4.
Something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And she's applying for...
A restaurant called Mimi's Cafe.
Yeah.
She's applying for a job.
Yeah.
All right.
She's applying to be your lady, too, Billy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
And also a little about Nicole. She had a boyfriend in the past, and he was in jail.
Wow.
Oh, for what?
Now he is for drugs.
All
right.
For drugs.
We're going with not a virgin there.
Yeah.
All right. That's all right.
We don't know.
Yeah. She's been single for a year now.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I asked her what she wanted, you know, what she likes to do in her spare time and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
She likes to gamble, and she says she can get into Casino Morongo without an ID.
Uh-huh. Well, that's... fantastic plug for them.
She's going to have to take me there.
Come on down with your fake IDs and gamble away your parents' money, kids.
With your drug-dealing boyfriend.
Sure. College, overrated.
They're going to crack down, though.
Okay, well, now they are.
And
maybe they'll crack down on advertising on this station. That'll probably be the first thing they crack down on. So Billy, one's a virgin. The other plays fast and loose with the gambling, rolling the dice, literally and figuratively, yes?
Yes.
Now, boyfriend in jail, and you've been single for a year.
Ex-boyfriend in jail, yeah.
You were dating this guy when you were 15?
No, I was dating him before I moved out here.
How old were you?
I'm 16.
16.
Just turned 17, yeah.
Just turned, but you're 17 now.
I'm 17 now. I'll be 18 in July.
Ah, I see.
So I moved out here last July and got away from all that. So.
How long is he in jail for?
He's supposed to be getting out in a couple months, I guess.
They're looking for one Billy, the webmaster. And meth, what was the drugs? He got caught dealing drugs?
No, he just went out and started stealing cars and got caught by the cops so he can get away. So.
Not to mention sex with a minor.
Yeah, how old is this guy?
He just turned 18. Right before he went to jail.
I don't mean to be intrusive, but Jewish or Asian? I know the types.
He was white, yeah.
White guy. White guy. Mm-hmm. All right. It's confused. Usually when you hear about drugs and underage sex and stealing cars and joyriding, you mean to think either Jew or Asian or possibly both. But Caucasian.
Yes.
All right. And you're attracted to Billy.
Yes.
All right. Well, cool. Billy, it is now time for you to make the big decision.
One question for Nicole real quick. Okay. How many boyfriends have you had?
I've had two boyfriends.
And you done it with them both?
do I have been? yes.
Okay. All right.
Listen, it's like buying a baseball mitt that's already been broken in.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's what you want. They already oiled it up and Dad parked the car on it overnight. You're ready to hit the field, buddy.
I think he's a little overwhelmed by Nicole.
Yeah, listen, everybody's had boyfriends.
Yeah.
Let me explain something. I'm sorry. But if you're a guy who's a slow starter, you got out of the gate a little bit slow when it comes to dating, or maybe the nads didn't drop until you're in high school, whatever it is, the women you end up going out with who started at a normal age are, of course, ahead of you because it's like a race and they started a couple blocks ahead of you. That's just the way it goes. So you can't hold it against them. They just started dating at 15, at 16. You've been a little retarded. And I don't mean retarded. Oh, actually, I do. Yeah. You've been
socially
a little slow in your dating, and now you're getting on board. So obviously the people you're getting on board with, people that have been had a couple dates before you, that's all.
Yeah. Are you going to give him advice or just let him make the decision on his own?
Well,
I feel like he needs guidance.
I feel like I don't want Nicole's dating experience to be a stumbling block for young Billy over here. All right. Also, Melinda?
Yeah?
It seems like your love for Billy isn't as strong as Nicole's is.
Well, because, like, I really don't know him, and I have to get to know the person first before, like, anything happens.
She's a sweet girl, though. That much is clear.
And I'll tell you what, she probably cleans up really well. Like, I can see her being stunning in her prom dress.
I agree. Both very attractive, but the fact that Nicole showed up, or I should say Melinda showed up wearing a sweatshirt says she's not
that
eager.
But she cleans up well.
I like what Nicole's wearing.
All right. Well, make your decision, young Billy.
Both of the girls are really nice, and I would have to say, Nicole, would you like to go to prom with me?
Of course I would.
Billy, don't rub your hands together maniacally like an evil genius.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Melinda, I know you feel like you should be disappointed, but you feel like you dodged a bullet. I don't blame you, but one day, 14 years from now, when you turn on the news and you find out the biggest software manufacturer in the world, the biggest company is run by Billy Webmaster, the guy you turned down for the prom, and him and Nicole are living on some 70-acre spread in Silicon Valley, you'll still probably be happy. Yeah. I gotta be honest.
Melinda,
all right.
She's a really nice girl, and she's definitely going to find somebody.
Thank you.
She doesn't. Oh, wow, that's got to hurt. Being sued by Billy.
No, that's not to be.
You're going to come back from this, kid.
No, listen, Billy explained to me the double-edged sword of being cut out of the kind of cloth we were both cut out of. On one hand, the world is your oyster. On the other hand, you leave a trail of broken hearts behind you, and that's tough to sleep with.
What are you going
to
do?
Yeah. All right, you're a lone wolf. Billy, you'll be going to the prom with Nicole. We'll get a full report on that when you come back. I guess Monday you're going out this Saturday, yes?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right.
Hey, Adam, I'm
going to go with no. in advance. See, to me, it's not the question, it's how the question is asked. Yeah. When someone goes, hey, buddy, you know, I'm all ears, because that means he's going to say you're funny. But when I get the, hey,
let me
Adam,
you.
Could I, it means you want to borrow
Adam,
money.
Can we?
No. Means you need a ride or you need money.
Mr. Carolla, let me rephrase.
Yes.
Would you like to...
No. Uh-oh. All right, but go ahead.
Would you like to sponsor my whole prom event?
You see?
How do you know?
What is this, March of Dimes?
It is $80 a ticket.
Yeah.
$80. You don't have $80?
Well, $160.
I can cover the prom tickets, but you know, I'm
tuxedo
stuck here making a dollar over minimum wage and
really? Yeah. Sounds like too much.
Yeah.
All right.
You're literally a millionaire.
I literally am, but I didn't get to become a millionaire by paying for tuxedos and patent leather shoes for every kid that needs to go to the prom.
Good point.
That's right. All right, I'll take care of you kids.
Oh, that's sweet.
Thank you so much.
Maybe you could put the logo for the Carolla show. You know, your device, your Carolla.
No, I'm gonna. Camping. No, you'll go shirtless, and I'll ride it on your back like goldenpalace.com.
All right.
Recyclarola. That's what I was gonna say. Recyclarola on his back.
Here's the point. I will see if we can get it sponsored. We can get a limo company to step up. Wow. Maybe we'll get Gary's Tuck Shop. And if not, and I have to pay for it myself, we'll just take it out of the deaf frat guy's kitty. Okay. Take a quick break. Be back with news and sports after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. Comedy, opinions, celebrities, news, sports, and so much more.
This is Tori Spelling. You're listening to the insert adjective here. Adam Carolla Show.
Oh, I get it.
He's as funny as he thinks he is. The Adam Carolla Show.
Sir, I think you're crazy. Can you prove to me you're not crazy?
Because the world produces intelligence. But you get in something that turns you against your religion. You want to deal with life, but you deal with drugs and poverty, not life. But you just want to deal with things because your education bring everything. I'm not against drugs and poverty, but let drugs take you down to our lower ground. Well, let's go.
Mm-hmm. That was the gal that Billy eliminated that got us down to two.
Bronchitis girl.
Yes.
She thinks she sleeps on an asbestos pillow.
Yeah. She was 180 bone dry.
Oh, she was a sweet girl.
Well, listen, it's no catch either.
Hey, she came in here. She came in here with lies. She
yes,
has a boyfriend.
She had a beau at home.
She got what she had coming to her.
Right. Murray?
Yeah.
You're crazy. You've been on hold since 6 a.m.
Yeah, I know. The long time thing has worn me down.
Mm. But you sound better.
Yeah. Maybe. For doing less.
Maybe the meds have kicked in.
You're a downer.
Oh, you call me a quaalude, the comedy quaalude?
Well, I don't know. I think, middle.
What, like lithium.
Middle. Yeah. What do you got going today? What's on the agenda?
You think retirement?
You've retired already.
Yeah, you're giving me an option for holding on less on your behalf.
Mm-hmm. I've not met you, but I bet you smell minty fresh.
Yeah.
All right.
Keep original all the time.
Mm-hmm. Here's the thing: when you're crazy, you're either super clean or super filthy. No in between. Either wash your hands 128 times a day, or you walk around with a sombrero filled with cockroaches. One or the other. There's no medium. There's no in between when you're crazy. I never run into the clean ones, by the way. All right, Murray.
Okay. One thing, is this a lead-in like Westinghouse does a support for the audience is better than the professionals.
All right, hold on.
Yes,
that's what this is. All right, we have to keep pushing forward. I just want to talk to Murray because he has been on hold since the beginning of the show? Since 6 o'clock?
Wow.
Okay. Keep hanging, buddy. Now it is time for the news with Teresa Strasser.
President Bush is expected to make an announcement tonight calling for thousands of National Guard troops to be deployed along the Mexican border. Critics of the plan argue that troops are weary from serving in Iraq. Currently, the Border Patrol is about 12,000 strong and patrols roughly a 2,000-mile border.
Yeah. Well, I'm all for it. I'm fine. Go do it. Put them in. They're called the National Guard, not the Iraqi Guard.
Florida officials hunting today for alligators that may have killed two people this weekend, bringing the total number of alligator-related deaths in Florida to three in a single week. Prior to the latest three, only 18 fatal gator attacks reported in Florida since 1948.
Well, the gators are now fighting back because basically what the gators had was 10 million years of unmolested good times.
Right.
Just everybody scared S-less of them. There's no creature in the animal kingdom that's not scared of a gator. And then 2 years ago, every J-O in khaki shorts started jumping on them and wrestling them to the ground. And the gators must have been like, what the F is going on here? Because all I would have to do is slide up onto the bank of the river and yawn, and all the villagers would clear out, and the antelopes and gazelles, everything would scatter. Now we go up there, and there's some yahoo who jumps on us and rolls us onto our back. So basically what they said is, it's time to reassert ourselves.
Yeah.
We need to drag a few helpless civilians into the river, take them down, deep six them, take them down to Davy Jones' locker and give them the death roll,
right.
And this will get people away from the river.
Croc
and that's
Hunter,
what happened.
That Croc Hunter guy?
He did
like,
it.
It's like when Stan Gable and the rest of the Alpha Betas felt like, hey, we're the BMOCs, and then the nerds frat house.
Oh, the nerds.
They all, there was a groundswell support for the nerds, and Stan Gable and company were like, what are we going to do, Ogre? So all they did, they went and reasserted themselves, and they trashed the house of the lamb.
It's exactly the same.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, I'd like to fly you out to Florida to counsel the grief-stricken families.
Yes.
And explain to them exactly how that example goes.
Creepy.
In entertainment news, on The Sopranos last night, Vito and Johnny Cakes move in together, and then they have the talk.
You don't understand. Vincent. I love you.
Oh.
Wait.
I love you, Johnny Cakes.
Ah.
I had to put my hand up.
Really? When they made out?
Physically put my, you know, like when you're looking into the sun. That's what guys making out. To me, it's looking into the sun. I had to hold my hand in front of me. My wife yelled at me because I can watch, you know, 12 hours of snuff pornography
right,
a day.
Kiss.
But two actors lock lips, and if they're male, had to physically hold the hand up. But it's got to suck because, you know, HBO, if they're going to have a gay couple, can't back down.
Right.
They can't just show them holding hands. They have to show them
kiss. They didn't show much, but it was clear Vito's a bottom.
The first kiss was, oh, yeah. Yeah, I had to hold my hand up.
Well, by the way, I've said it before. I'll say it again. Why would Johnny Cakes go for gay Vito?
I know, but
Johnny Cakes is he's a Fu Manchu, firefighting, cool dude who flips flapjacks and stuff. You know, he's a cool guy. What do you got with this tub for?
Let me tell you about the gay community.
Please.
There are dudes that are super butch and have six-pack abs who dig the fatties.
Mm-hmm.
There's a whole sect of them.
Yeah.
You know, they have their
like
categories.
A daddy thing.
Yeah, we don't, the straight community, we want young, we want foxy. Oh, doesn't matter if you're black, Asian, white, Latina, whatever. Give us young, give us foxy. We're into you. The gays, they got a thing. They like the bears.
Mm-hmm.
Some like the big hairy guys.
Yeah.
Others like the big fat guys. There's a whole.
Yeah, there's a whole bar in San Francisco, Daddy's, where I grew up.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you find your big, at least back in the day, you find your big bear guy there.
Right.
You know, there's something for everyone.
Yeah, that's how it works.
Paula Abdul came out and told Teen People that she can no longer be objective. Elliot Yameen should win Idol. She also took credit, saying that she made America wake up and see the talent that Elliot possesses.
Oh, she's such a humanitarian. She makes more money than any crazy person I've ever met in my life. I'm so jealous of her life, sitting there judging. And never having to play the heavy either, telling everyone they're great.
No.
I mean, imagine, not only do you say 12 syllables a show and get paid $150,000 for the 12 syllables, but you never even have to play the heavy. All you do is just go, oh, that was wonderful, you've improved, you're amazing, and then you lose your words, you're so choked up at the end of every at the end of gushing, and you never even look bad. What a life.
God bless her.
Mm.
At the box office this weekend, Mission Impossible 3 still at the top spot. I'm Teresa Strasser, and that is the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
The Clippers with their backs to the walls last night in the Staples Center. Pulled it out, 114-107. Led, of course, by Elton Brand, as always. 30 points from him. The series is now tied at 2. I enjoyed the
That's
game
immensely. That's great news for all us longtime Clipper fans. I've always been a huge Clipper fan.
I've seen you there.
You've heard me talk about the Clippers.
You're
my Clippers. I love Clippers. I've always been a big Clippers fan. Never did care for the Lakers.
You and millions of others. Everybody, everywhere I go now, all of a sudden, red and blue everywhere you see.
Clipper
a
fever,
sea
man.
Of red and blue
That's
in the
right.
Staples Center. I'm driving around the streets this weekend. Suddenly, those red and blue flags that once were purple and gold have now been changed to Clippers faithful.
Yes.
Shame on you all. That's what I say.
Turncoats.
Feel shame.
Benedict Arnold's.
Front running. Bandwagon jumping creeps. That's what y'all are. Billy Crystal, Frankie Muniz. And 7 or 8 other people care about this team
Adam
legitimately.
Was there from the start.
Always a huge Clipper fan.
I say shame. Even their owner hates them. Donald Sterling doesn't even like the team.
All right.
All of a sudden, everyone in L.A. is huge Clipper fans. I've always been with them. Here's a little rule. If you've never been to a Clippers game before, you don't get to go now.
Mm.
How about I've been
that?
To many.
If you like haven't that. Watched an entire Clippers game on TV, you shouldn't suddenly be cheering when they win now.
I feel like a stalker who, if I got too close to the Clippers, would attempt to rape them. I feel like I never went to a Clippers game because I love them that much,
right.
And I never watched them
it
on
was
TV.
To protect them.
Yes, it was for them, but I've had a silent love for the Clippers over the years. Oh, yes, my friend. One I've never been able to share with anyone until today.
Now, national pastime, Dodgers, Oakland, Arizona Snakes, and the first place Padres, all winners yesterday. On the downside, the Halos, 6 games under now, and the Giants lost. No home runs, most importantly, for Barry the Creep Bonds. So now, when everybody had anticipated him tying and perhaps breaking Babe Ruth's record in front of San Francisco's faithful, now he has to go to Houston and get booed when he hits the home run, and it's going to be marvelous.
That's why I've now decided to name my son Lou. Because if he ever becomes a professional athlete and he takes the field and people boo, he just thinks they're yelling Lou.
Yep.
Nice.
Lou, because they do that with Lou's.
Yeah,
they
and
sound
it
like
always
boos,
sounds like boo.
But everyone always corrects them. Well, it sounds like they're doing the Bronx jeer or whatever, but
go all the way.
It's
go
Lou.
Go like Orioles first baseman, the legend, Boog Pow.
Boo Pow.
Wasn't there a Laker point guard, Lou, Tyrone Lou, somebody like that? And they sounded
That's
like
right,
Lou.
Lou.
That's right. We just
right.
go Lou.
Start
that bullet.
Stanley Cup playoffs. The San Jose Sharks, at one point up 2-0 in their series, have now lost 3 straight.
Mm.
Chi-Chu now. Talk about back to the wall. He must win.
Mm.
Or the Chi-Chu-Temu series, the Sharks versus Ducks, shall not be. Mm. Don't people realize? Doesn't Chi-Chu realize? That this is like Halley's Comet. The opportunity. If Halley's Comet only came once, though.
Right.
When are we ever going to see Chi-Chu versus Temu?
Yeah.
Please, Chi-Chu, don't let this fall through. I've written another song about it, as a matter of fact.
You.
This one in honor of Adam Carolla's favorite band, The Who.
Mm-hmm.
About Chi-Chu and Temu. Here you are.
Chi-Chu. Chi-Chu.
Same song Chris Daughtry wanted to do, right?
Temu.
What's the opposite of serendipity?
Chi-Chu Temu. Stanley Cup story. Chi-Chu Temu. I get the heat.
You're lucky I love
Hey Moo, when will you meet?
Well, as long as you do those songs, we'll be all right.
My life has never been more pathetic.
Even your mom just turned it off.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
All right, we need to take ourselves a break. Frank Vincent, you know Miss Phil Leotardo from The Sopranos, is going to be phoning in, giving us a little Sopranos update. We'll talk to him after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. This is what a year and a half of junior college sounds like.
Let me explain the genius of Gene Simmons, not only in the marketing of Kiss, but the marketing of his own testicles.
Every woman complains that none of the guys tell her the truth. So you should look into the eyes of your beloved and say, I desire you with every inch of my being, but I want your mommy and your sister too. As long as you get that out of the way, then you're fine.
Yeah, smart.
A million opinions and only one eyebrow. The Adam Carolla Show.
I'm not a writer, okay? I'm actually from New Jersey.
Heard about Bobby Bacala?
You know who the f*** I am?
Yeah, my sister pulled with the breaking news.
You got what you want. Please don't, I got kids.
Moment of truth.
They're going to recommend 15 years.
15 f***ing years.
In 15 years, you'll be 67. The golden years.
I'll take it.
Johnny's a silent partner. Says Phil Leotardo shouldn't be involved. Just know John's asking as a friend.
Speaking of Phil Leotardo, Frank Vincent.
Right here.
How are you, my brother?
Good, pal. How are you?
I'm doing very well. I watched last night, as I always do. I noticed that Gay Vito drove back into the old hood.
I think he's looking for some, he wants to get back with his, maybe his wife and kids. I think he's a little confused, don't like to work construction.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
Johnny Cakes is maybe not hitting the mark or something.
I said, well, maybe they're both bottoms. That happened to me once. I hooked up with the bottom and said, this is great. We both just got down and bent over. And after 20 minutes, noticed, wait a minute. Nothing is going on. There's barely any reaming going on here. Calling all homos. It's tough. Yeah, it's like one's on the metric system. The other's on the standard system. Oh, you can't do it. You can't use it.
Can't use it.
No, that's why.
Let's go back to the other one.
You got
to
wear the brown bandana in the right pocket. Otherwise, you'll be just as screwed as I wasn't.
I can't imagine, man. Can you imagine? I don't know what Joe Ganascoli's thinking about.
When I saw him making out last night, I had to hold my hand up in front of the television set, yeah. Frank. I could not watch.
Frank, you've never done a gay scene.
No. I've played my own sister in drag.
Oh, you have?
But I wasn't a lesbian. I was regular.
You were straight. Regular. I like that.
Go home and get your f***ing shine box.
Yeah, call it normal. All right, so let's see. I watched, obviously, the Here's What's Coming Up, and it looks like Frank, a.k.a. Phil Leotardo, is all over the upcoming episodes. And
Looks like
you may catch up to Gay Vito, yes?
Yes, next two.
This thing's coming to head.
Yeah, that's going to be good.
Listen to this analogy. Tony went to see Melfi, and he talked about the possibility of him having sex with his sister at a younger age.
Right.
And now he gave her the house, and she came in crying. Mm-hmm. And like, how deep is that?
Yeah, it's getting, you know, he's sitting there with the shrink and talking about having feelings, sexual feelings toward his older sis. The whole thing's taking a turn for the bizarre, sexually at least.
I'll tell you, Chase is nuts.
Yeah, he really is nuts. So when you guys come back after these next two episodes?
January 07.
January 07 and eight more.
Eight more. We start shooting end of June.
After that, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, Frank, I'm sorry we're running late and out of show. I want to give a plug, frankvincent.com. You can get the book, The Guy's Guide to Being a Man's Man.
Right.
Frank, we'll do longer next week. I'm sorry, we just got pushed back here.
No problem. Next week, we're going to have a lot to talk about.
All right. Ooh. Frank Vincent, everybody. And with that, that's our show. I want to thank Chris Daughtry. Jeff Richards is going to be at the Improv Wednesday, 10 o'clock, for the 10 o'clock show. Go to tastyjeff.com for more information. And, of course, Frank Vincent. And until next time, it's Adam Carolla saying mahalo.